Anyway, so this is Talkaoke, this is Shambala. My name's Mikey. What more is there to say? Well, quite a lot, I hope. This is Talkaoke. Welcome, you're the first people here. You're kind of, at the moment we don't have a camera person, but hopefully through a combination of excitement, drunkenness and charm, we'll get somebody competent on the camera. We will see. Hello, come and take a seat. We've just started. This is an opportune moment. The way Talkaoke works is very simple. I've explained it already, talking to this microphone, about whatever you want. It's kind of up to you. Take it in whatever direction you want to go in. As I said, my name's Mikey. Let's just find out who else we've got around the table. I'm just getting a bit lower. I like to be low. What's your name?
My name's Stuart.
And?
Natasha.
Yep.
Sisla.
Yep.
Laura.
Yep.
Zoe.
Zoe, welcome. So, it's quite simple. Has anyone got anything they want to get the ball rolling with? Anything they want to talk about? Any ideas, thoughts, comments, interjections, observations?
That's a lovely shirt, Mikey.
Yeah.
Very nice shirt, Mikey.
Yes. Oh, thank you. Thank you. I wasn't sure because I sort of feel like I am, and this goes to Ed as well. I don't know if you all know Ed, the person that invited me and the Talkaoke crew here. We're sort of outside of fashion, do you know what I mean? We're kind of like following our own path. Like, for example, today I've seen quite a big kind of Conchita Wurst sort of thing going on.
Oh, there is.
Ed was doing that in 2012. Ed was 3 years ahead of the curve.
No idea, yeah.
So anyway, but this show is not about me, it's about you. So where do you want to take it? What do you want to talk about? Maybe this person here is gonna help us get this going. We've just started. This is Talkaoke. It's a free-form talk show. You can talk about whatever you want to talk about. We've got Stuart, we've got Natasha, we've got Sisla, Laura and Zoe, and my name's Mikey. What's your name?
Hi, I'm Tilda.
And?
I'm Dan.
Dan?
Kiga.
Kiga. I'm just going to turn this up. So, I'll just explain, this is Talkaoke, it's a free-form talk show. So far, the only comment we've had is about my shirt, but then we've only just started.
It's a great shirt.
It is a good shirt, but I mean, where do we want to take...
It's a great shirt, and you've got great chest hair.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. That is true. There's a lot of hair. Maybe we could talk about kind of male body hair, which seems to be much more acceptable now.
Let's talk about the cross-dressing that's occurred today.
Yeah.
So, I'm a bit upset, actually.
Yeah.
Because I saw someone wearing a skirt that I have.
Right.
In one of the reggae tents back there. Yeah. It's a gold, glittery sequin skirt.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Can you retrace the sequence of events?
Sequence of events.
Just warming this up, you know.
good stuff.
The problem was, his pins looked so good. And he just killed it.
Okay, do you think you'll ever wear that skirt again?
Probably not. I'm going to burn
it. Okay. So what happens if you see a man wearing a dress that you own? That's one of the questions. We could ask about the phenomenon of cross-dressing. Is it something that, you know, I mean, actually, we'd remarked on it before you'd sat down. There is definitely a movement going on here.
Now there's far more women than men at the festival. The ratio is just...
Right, so it messes up the...
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, okay. The upside ratio of men to women. What are the girls going to do now? What are the real women going to do?
Okay.
We're thinking about glitter beards. We think that could be a possible option.
A glitter beard.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a kind of camped up sort of...
Yeah. Got to keep that feminine edge about
you as well.
I quite
like that. Yeah. Yeah. At the moment, we're talking about cross-dressing. Is that a phenomenon that... Come and tell us about it, because... Is it a phenomenon... They're a bit shy, because it's not quite in the mainstream yet. Glitter beard. Have you ever cross-dressed, Stuart?
I have, but I tend to be cross-dressed by other people, like my lovely colleagues here.
Okay.
They always stitch me up.
Does it make you cross?
No, it doesn't. It's quite liberating, isn't it?
Okay.
The last time you cross-dressed, that was your own choice. Rose.
Rose.
Yeah, you bought that dress.
Okay.
Do
men actually need? Do they need an excuse? We're talking about cross-dressing. Do men need an excuse to cross-dress?
Hell no.
You say no, but I sort of feel like you're saying you need someone else to tell you to cross-dress in order to make it okay.
They just need pushing over the edge slightly, don't you?
You just need that final push.
That little nudge.
Come and get involved in this. This is Talkaoke. We're talking at the moment. We're talking about the phenomenon of cross-dressing. Is it going to be something that grows out of this festival?
Well, we're with a guy who every time he cross dresses, he pulls, yeah. and he pulls
right.
a woman.
Right.
So I don't know if it's a pulling tactic.
Is cross dressing for men a pulling tactic? Do you think does it make
yeah? Yes. Aussie guys, footy boys, are always cross-dressing. They freaking love it. Yeah, and they always pull.
Right, okay, why?
It's an Aussie, because they're comfortable with their sexuality. They don't care.
Okay, that means you're comfortable. Yeah, that means you're comfortable and confident.
My friend I've been with twice this year and last year has pulled twice.
Right.
And he never has a girlfriend, but he's had two girlfriends from being a woman at Shambala.
Okay, so...
women dig it, some women don't.
I mean, what happens then afterwards? Does it all go wrong when he sort of goes a bit straighter later?
One of them lasted a year, so I think the straightness worked. Straighter later.
Right, but the initial kind of pulling, let's call it, it's helped. It's facilitated by cross-dressing. People agree with this?
Buoyant character, confident, and definitely a talking point.
But I mean,
because you'd go up to them like, great tits, and they'd be like, you have great tits. Then you're like, oh well, okay, here we go, you fancy me, I fancy you, let's go.
Is it really that simple? And we've been missed, you know, it's that simple. Okay, right, okay, well there you go, problem solved, now we know. So where do we want to go? I mean, do we think is this gonna kind of like bleed out of Shambala and festivals at large into the high street?
It's Secret Garden. It's quite common for boys to dress as girls as well. I think it's like, if as long as there's lots of sparkles and like.
Yeah. Would you ever wear a glitter beard? Because basically, some of the women around the table are saying we need to fight back. We need to think of like innovative ways to cross-dress the other way.
I don't know. It depends on. I'm not really. I don't really want to dress as a guy. But if you're into that, do it.
I mean.
I don't know.
Do you think men are really into it, or are they just doing it in order to pull? Are they into it?
If you want to be loud, if you want to express yourself and be loud, then do it. Do whatever you want to do. If you want to wear a gold glitter beard, then do it.
Well, I mean, I think the gold glitter beard is more the other way around. It's like, do women actually feel a need to cross-dress and be, and sort of, I don't know what it...
Women need feel more need to dominate in the workforce and actually get in career and excel and do well in to fight masculinity in that way.
Yeah.
Because you want to be respected and not treated because you've got a pair of tits or something. That's a more feminist...
Do you think wearing a beard would help in that
respect? No.
Okay, I mean, what would help? I mean, what is the right way to dress to be respected in the workplace?
We should just wear a strap-on to work. I think that would be a much better option.
Okay. Well, maybe that...
Actually show a penis. Just get it
out. That could be a look, maybe, for next year's Shambala. We could say it started here. The strap-on... But would it be like an...
We could put it all glitter all over it so that it looks a bit more
Wouldn't it be a bit more of a kind of executive kind of like mahogany strap-on rather than something... because you're thinking like the workplace business, you know...
Cigar and your mahogany strap-on.
Okay. Would that help you to be respected in the workplace, a strap-on penis? Definitely. What do people think?
Yeah.
You think yes?
Yes, definitely.
Okay. I mean, do people actually think that this is still an issue in 2015 that... Women are not respected enough in the workplace.
Well, fortunately, yes.
Yeah. What's that?
Well, I was going to say that cross-dressing as a man, as I've done a few times, is actually really liberating because you become desexualized quite easily as a woman when you become a man.
So you become what, asexual, you mean?
No, not asexual, desexualized.
What does that mean?
When you go into this male persona, suddenly you're not a sexual object anymore, which is very liberating.
Right.
So you don't have this like gaze.
So actually. Dressing kind of male is desexualizing. Can we get involved with this? We're talking about cross-dressing. How do women get more respect in the workplace? Is it by wearing a mahogany strap-on? Would you respect a woman with a mahogany strap-on?
I think I would.
So, I mean, the whole point about talking... This is Talkaoke, by the way, if you don't know. It's a free-form pop-up talk show. You can talk about whatever you want to talk about. So where do you want to take this? Do you want to talk about discrimination in the workplace? Do you want to talk about cross-dressing? This idea of, that Natasha said, of desexualizing. Do people feel the need to desexualize?
Maybe
or ACDC
sexualize the men as well, make them the sexual object, like flip it around. Have them wearing nipple tassels and like little budgie smugglers.
You're up for that?
I'd be up for that, yeah.
Okay, so men, it's about time men became the sexual object. That's what we're talking about. Come and take a seat. You've got one.
Perfect timing.
So we're talking about it's a very big phenomenon. And I saw one or two people kind of like with a full beard wearing a wig and a dress in 2012 at Shambala. One or two people. But now it seems to be like loads and loads of men are doing it. And this is where what we're talking about. Is this a phenomenon? Will it bleed out of Shambala into the workplace? What people are saying is the way to get more respect in the workplace as a woman is to wear a mahogany strap-on. It's a combination of people.
Yeah.
It's a combination of people. So then what we're basically talking about is like, in a way, it's about the way you dress and the kind of, does that objectify you, subjectify you, sexualize, desexualize you? That's what we're talking about at the moment.
I do find it interesting because now, like, being, I know, like because getting gay marriage and stuff is illegal in the US, gay seems to be kind of like the new fashionable thing. Like, it's so funny. All my gay friends are like, I told someone I was gay today, and they're like, oh, that's all the rave right now. And he's like, what? I mean, so I feel like because gay's more accepting, like, you know, women being able to vote now is accepted, where it never used to be. So I feel like being gay is totally being accepted now, as it should be. So I feel like if you want to experiment with your sexuality, if you want to try on some glitter, if you want to do any of that thing, it's more accepted now. And
okay,
I think that's totally awesome.
Is cross-dressing, I'm going to go to the men, have you got experience with cross-dressing, is it experimenting with your sexuality?
I think it's just having the excuse.
Mm.
Definitely having the excuse.
Right.
You always wanted to try on a little bit of glitter, didn't you? Yeah. You're always scared.
Okay, well this is what, I mean earlier on we sort of picked up this thing that men really want to, you know, wear women's clothes, but they need a push, just a little push.
But I think at festivals it might also be that like a dress is really quite useful because you can kind of just like pull it up and go to the loo.
Yeah.
And I think maybe it's you know, not
it's
only do they get
spandex,
to be fucking superb
be
women, but they also just can like whip it up and have a shit, which is just useful.
Okay, right.
I think men just, you know,
so
very ladylike.
Dresses are better for shitting in, we've discovered as well. I didn't know that actually. I don't think I've ever taken a shit. I've never taken a dump wearing a dress. I'll try that later on. Someone might need to lend me some of their attire. I'm not going to borrow yours because otherwise you'll never wear it again. Of course it.
That's how they retain their masculinity when they're dressing as a woman, like doing an act like that.
Right.
Brings it all back.
Okay, so. So I mean, we're talking about.
Yeah. I actually think that a lot of the blokes here just do it to get more female attention.
There you go.
Yeah, I think there's actually a kind of ulterior motive here. It's not just about experimenting with their own sexuality. In fact, it's reinforcing their existing sexuality because you get a lot more female attention when you're in drag.
Right, okay, so you think, we talked about this a bit earlier on, that it's actually the reason that men are wearing dresses is because they've discovered they actually get more attention and they actually can actually be more masculine, but in a more sort of...
Maybe it's also that women might feel more comfortable around other women, and therefore if a man is dressed as a woman, that kind of initial barrier is removed, and then they can just be like, oh yeah, whatever, and suddenly there you are pulling, and you just haven't even realised.
Do people feel... Do you feel more comfortable around men in drag?
No. This is what I was saying.
This guy
who was wearing my skirt looked better than I do in my skirt.
So somewhat uncomfortable.
Yeah, I was not happy.
Okay, so there are, you know, there are negative consequences here. I mean,
I think they got to make sure that they're not prettier than women, because then we just get angry.
Okay. Can men be prettier than women? Can they? Yeah.
Not the time they have better jawlines and like more defined and stuff, and they're like, because boy figures like in at the moment, so you see a guy in like girls' clothes and they look like something off Urban Outfitters catalogue.
Right, okay, so...
Pins. Yeah. They put heels on and then their quads look amazing and their calves. We have to work for that shit.
Okay, see, so, I mean, maybe... You know, if we just kind of rewind through history, there were times when kind of fashions for men and women were reversed, and it was the men that wore skirts. And are we at that tipping point, do you think, where even the very notion of a dress is actually going to be considered masculine?
Well, there are those
these new like long tank tops that men have started wearing.
Yeah.
They come down to like mid thigh. They're quite dress like, and they're really trendy at the moment. Yeah, they're just going to get longer and longer.
Are we at a tipping point? Where we're going to have a flip, like the Earth's polarity flipping as it does every few thousand years? You think that would be good?
Yeah, girls can wear pants, so boys can wear a skirt, whatever.
I mean, will that be the new work? Maybe in
yeah,
that.
Scottish yeah. What about kilts?
Yeah.
They do it.
They look very masculine.
They're working it. But they don't wear any underwear. Yeah. That's quite hot.
Yeah. I mean,
that's men in kilts are therefore sluts. Is that wrong? Is it liberating to wear no knickers?
Okay, I mean, has anyone looked at some of these men in dresses, wondering if whether they're wearing any knickers or not? And are they sluts?
I meant there's a slightly rhetorical question. As a kilt-wearing man myself,
yeah.
I
do you feel like a slut?
No.
Okay.
I feel liberated and free.
Do you get a lot of aeration downstairs?
Well, yeah. When you've got 8 yards of wool wrapped around your waist, it does get quite warm.
Okay. Okay. All right. So he's not really cross-dressing. He's wearing the kind of trousers, and that's not cross-dressing, is it? We're talking about the phenomenon of cross-dressing. Are we at a tipping point where it's going to flip and actually men start wearing women's clothes, women start wearing men's clothes, it's just normal, and that becomes a new normal? That's what we're talking about right now. You're confused.
What's normal?
Okay, what's normal? That's a very good question. I don't know. It's not for me to say. That's what we're talking about. Any comments? What's normal? Does anyone want to answer that? Help me out here.
Well, here, normal is cross-dressing.
Yeah. Has it become the new normal?
In this context, yeah.
Do you see yourself as normcore?
Normcore?
Yeah.
What, normal to the hardcore?
Yeah.
Normal to the extreme?
Yeah.
Extreme normalness.
Yeah. Are you extremely normal? Okay, well, there we go. So that is, there we go, I've answered the question. So basically we're talking about how things change, and are we at a tipping point is basically the what we're talking about, really, a tipping point.
I don't think it's going to be a tipping point. I think it's just a gradual, like...
Yeah.
Acceptance.
Yeah, acceptance, yeah.
I mean, has anyone here got a job? Yes. What about if someone came to work wearing a man came to work wearing a dress?
That's happened before, hasn't it?
Yeah, has it happened?
Well, away days last year, Ed was dressed as a woman for a bigger
part. Well, was it like a business suit, or was it a bit more?
Well, he was dressed as our other co-founder, so in her business suit. Yeah.
Right. Okay. So it's happened
already.
How did you
feel? Was it empowering, Ed?
What, doing an impression of Sully? I'm not sure that's empowering.
I mean, do you think that will just become the normcore, just wearing a two-piece?
Yeah, well, possibly.
To work?
Mean, there's two theories of change, isn't there? There's punctuated equilibria or phyletic gradualism. So do changes happen gradually, as my learned friend over there was suggesting, or do they happen in sudden changes? So maybe it could be a tipping point where everyone goes back to work on Tuesday, and having had the experience of Shambhala, just goes... Fuck it, I'm going to wear a dress.
Yeah, okay. How likely is that?
Unlikely, but...
Totally depends on the job.
Okay, what job do you do?
I'm an outdoor man.
Yeah?
Outdoor instructor, so if I turned up in a skirt, I'd just get really cold.
Absolutely. Yeah, so, absolutely. And people
so
could
probably,
see...
But I do go climbing in leggings, so...
Right, okay, so a bit like what this man
exactly,
here is wearing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so... Well, I mean, maybe what we actually need is somebody to say, I'm going to go to work, a man to say, I'm going to go to work in a dress. Or maybe, I mean, I guess it's not that, it wouldn't be that surprising if a woman went to work wearing a suit, maybe with a glittery beard. But maybe we need somebody to actually say, right, this is the new normal. Maybe it could be you, sir. Yeah. Would you consider going to work wearing that? Wearing what you're wearing now? I know it's not really a dress.
I'd have my clients to think about. They may not. They may think of me differently, maybe.
Okay, what clients have you got?
It might make finding business a slightly more difficult.
Okay.
But maybe I find a different kind of business.
Okay, okay, words. Well, it's all about business. It's all about making money. I mean, earlier on we were talking about how do women get more respect in the workplace? And a mahogany strap-on was suggested by a combination of people, me included, actually. What was it?
Glitter strap-on.
Yeah, there was a glitter strap-on as well. But, yeah, I don't know. A glitter dip strap-on. That's what we're talking about here. We're talking about the phenomenon of cross-dressing. There's a few new people around the table. Yeah.
A glitter dip strap-on? Is that what you were just talking about?
Basically, the question was...
I want to know more.
How do women get more respect at what... apparently, I haven't got a job myself, but apparently in the workplace, women are not getting enough respect.
Really? Well, they need to get a strap-on and... have a glitter around their dick.
But would mahogany be better or glitter as a strap-on, do you think, for respect in the workplace?
My God, mahogany, stop it. You're telling me on now. Oh, my God. Mahogany strap-on dick on.
Yeah. Okay, what's that? Can you just
a mahogany strap-on?
For respect in the workplace, it's not actually for use. It's more...
anal or vaginal is obviously, like, something that needs to be considered.
Oh, Michael, stop it. I don't know.
No, it's more of an effect mahogany strap on. It's not actually for use.
I tell you what.
Yeah.
Any holes a goal?
Okay, this is Talkaoke Free From Talk Show. Talk about whatever you want to talk about. Do we want to talk about strap-ons? It seems it's a very popular subject. Do we want to talk about cross-dressing? Do we want to talk about the new normal?
There is a nipple tassel workshop here at Shambala.
Yeah. Is that for men and women?
That's for... I would say it's probably directed at women, but as our conversation is progressing, perhaps men will be getting involved as well.
Yeah.
Join us in the nipple tassel workshop.
Okay. Okay.
Do we know when it is?
Yeah.
We're not sure if it's creation and then also how to like swing it. But
right, okay, swinging the nipples.
Woo! We're not sure yet. We want to find out. We're definitely going to go.
We're finding out. We've got all information here. There was a hugging workshop going on. Some people just before we were setting up were going off to a hugging workshop. Do people need a workshop to hug? I don't know. What's that?
It just makes you feel better. You don't need hugs. Hugs right. just.
No, but I mean, I thought. Oh, the workshop isn't like how to hug better.
No.
I think we definitely need hugs.
What about strap-on workshop?
There is a need. There is a need aspect to that. It's not just an added bonus.
Okay, so you think people need hugs and they're not getting
enough
hugs?
But they have to be at least 20 seconds long.
Really?
Because when you have a 20-second hug, that's what... That's what creates the oxytocin in the brain.
Really?
That gives you the empathy molecule.
Okay.
And by the way, now that you're all watching me being hugged, you're probably enjoying the sensation.
Right, we're getting
through
oxytocin.
Mirror neurons, so you're
we're
all
getting
now feeling
oxytocin too.
Yeah.
Okay, we've got another 5 seconds, I think, roughly.
You're really warm.
That's why he doesn't wear any underwear when he's got a kilt on. Okay, right. Okay, so hugging is good. Where do we want to go with this conversation? We've got too many threads now.
We went to go check out the healing area earlier, and they had some very quiet yoga session going on, and there were just two people standing in the middle of it whilst everyone was doing their yoga, just hugging. They were there the whole time we were standing there. We were there for about a good 5 minutes.
Doing in one hug, or they
just one just really, long really long hug.
Yeah,
but it was really nice to watch as well.
Right. Okay. I mean, what's the optimum length of time for a hug?
It did feel like we were missing out. An optimum time.
Yeah.
Definitely around 20 seconds. It's got to be. And you got to link arms properly.
Yeah. I mean, is there a moment?
There is a way of doing it.
Yeah. Yeah. Is there a moment when a hug can a hug last too long? Do people think?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Say yes.
It just gets all kinds of awkward.
Yeah.
If it lasts too long.
Is it after 20 seconds or before 20 seconds, or does it sort of?
Okay. After 20 seconds.
Can you do it? What I'd like to know.
Workshop. I spoke to people on the bus coming here, and they told me you have to hug someone for 20 minutes.
20 minutes.
So you build
one person.
One person for 20 minutes. So you build up, right? So you do little hugs with lots of people, and then you have one person for 15 or 20 minutes, and you literally stand there like this for 20 minutes. And I said it gets really awkward at that point.
I think a hug gets awkward when a man puts the leg in between and just puts the leg in between.
Oh, a bit of crime.
And you know that they're just trying to press against you a bit too much. Yeah. And you're like, this isn't doing anything
for me. If that's happening after like 20 seconds, 30 seconds, what do you do for the other 19 and a half minutes? Do we need workshops for hugging?
Apparently, there are so many questions about hugging.
How do you get, apart from obviously we've heard about the leg grind.
The bum group.
Are there any other, what's that?
The bum group.
Right, okay.
Cheeky bum group. And you're cheeky, like, oh, the, like, I thought we were friends.
The cheeky kiss on the cheek as you go in.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, or like on the neck when you're there. Just,
A little nuzzle. Okay, does anyone know anyone that gives really good hugs and how do they actually do it? Yeah, yeah.
Like in the nook, in like. And you really squeeze.
Yeah.
And you have to wear a tail.
Okay, looks like your tail's going up.
Yeah,
now.
She's excited. Tail, yeah.
They've got the wrong idea. What's
you
that?
Have to do open hugging, so you have to do the heart to heart. So it has to
what
be left
mean?
Chest to left chest.
Left chest in.
Yeah, left chest in, leading.
Right, okay. Okay.
One arm over, one arm under. Yeah, that was so quite right.
Sounds like you guys know your stuff.
It's way better if they're way taller than you and you can go right underneath and they can go right over the top.
So you think it's better to have an asymmetrical hug than a symmetrical hug?
No one ever knows which way to do that and then you just kind of bump around and you don't know them.
Isn't it like left into the heart? Is that that? Yeah.
Going at an angle, you're both like, hey! And then
you're like,
woo! Any other hugging tips from this side?
But there's also there's the awkwardness when you hug someone who doesn't want to be hugged.
Yeah.
So for example, at my current job, I hugged the person that interviewed me when I left, and I found out later that she hates hugs.
Did you get the job?
Yeah, I did.
Okay, well there you go.
I'm thinking it wasn't because of the hug, or maybe I'm an excellent hugger.
Maybe she's changed her mind about the hug.
Yeah. Yeah.
I hugged
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Why?
I mean, has anyone else given someone a hug at an interview? It seems a bit.
We have a colleague who high-fived her interviewer in an interview.
Okay. To me, that would be more. I'm like high-fiving, but I wouldn't hug someone at an interview. Not that I've ever had a job. So.
High-fiving's worse than a hug.
Yeah.
High-fiving. Yeah.
And if you miss.
It's so awkward.
How do you think that went? It's like it went great.
For the first time, and being British rather than like you know Spanish, what do you go for? Like you meet someone's friend, and it's like it's always awkward. You go for a hug, two kisses, one kiss. That's why I always go in for a side, and they know it's a hug.
Right.
If
okay.
you go in leaning, otherwise it's like, do I do one, two, or do I accidentally get you on the lips?
So you think it's a bit hard?
There's no ruling.
There's no rules. There's no rules about how to greet and ungreet. Well, I guess that's also greeting, isn't it?
Aussies have one kiss,
really?
And Europeans have two.
See,
French have three.
Have we have nothing.
You really?
Yeah.
Well, okay. So, are people aware of this? Like, is it good to have a lack of? Is it bad to have a lack of rules? A lack of protocol?
Have a lack of rules because you have no idea what you're doing. And half the time, if you go in for a hug and they'll go in for the handshake, and that's the worst one, I reckon, is when they stab you in the stomach.
Okay.
That's really awkward if you're going in for handshake.
That's a really informal greeting, isn't it?
I mean, especially like I work as a doctor, and there I sometimes have awkward moments with patients wanting to give me a hug, and then it's like, okay.
I always wonder if I should
high-fiving them now. Actually,
I always wonder if I should shake my doctor's. I always wonder if I should shake my doctor's hand because, like. You just think, she doesn't want me to shake her hand. Do you know what I mean? I sort of get that feeling.
My mate met the Queen of England's gynecologist, and he shook their hand for a very long time, being like, this is the hand that's been in the Queen's vagina. I mean, you know, that's closest you'll get to royalty.
Okay.
As close as you can get to royalty.
Okay. Are there other ways? Has anyone got closer to royalty? Have you shaken the hand of the man that's shaken the hand of the Queen's gynecologist?
I have. Yeah, I have.
Okay. So that's,
I'm in there.
That's 3 degrees of separation, isn't it?
There's a great story about Fiona.
Yeah.
There's a great story about Fiona Bruce, the TV presenter and newsreader. And she was saying that when she was having her second child, she was in the delivery room and the kind of the gynecologist who was between her thighs at the time, expecting the delivery of her second child, said, I know this might seem an odd moment, but I really admire your work. And she was like, now is not the time.
Okay.
I've definitely had that when I was going for, I mean, this is very personal, and I was going for my smear test and I'd worked in the delivery ward of the hospital before.
Right.
And as this woman is between my legs with her, like, speculum insert and everything, she's like,
"You're Kirsten's daughter, aren't you?" And I was like, "Yes, how are the kids?" And like, we had this great chat, and it was, yeah. And afterwards I told my mate, and she was like, "You actually had a conversation about this woman's holiday while she was looking into your vagina." I was like, "Wow." Just seemed like the right point. So okay. I think just let it, you know, let it happen.
Let it happen, let it all hang out. We're talking about, hello.
How are you?
I'm very good.
Thank you.
Okay, give us a final thought before you go. Is there anything here that's been said that you think you're actually going to remember?
You guys were awesome. Thanks for the chat.
Where are you going?
I've got to pick up my GoPro. It's on charge, so I have to
okay,
go.
Okay, okay. You're doing some...
Put more glitter on.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know why we're avatar, but we didn't want to be a woman or a man, so we're like animals.
So it's back to this kind of cross-dressing thing.
Yeah, we'll leave it.
It's like we've been talking a lot about cross-dressing. Are we at a tipping point? Things are getting very mixed up.
You are here. I haven't seen a man wear trousers yet so far. Okay, I've only been here 10 minutes.
Okay. There's a man wearing trousers. He's always ahead of a curve, Ed is. Thanks for coming to sit down, and it sounds like you're a camera person.
She is.
So yeah. If you want to come back and do a bit of camera work, because our camera person is asleep.
I've got lots of space on my GoPro, so I'm planning on taking lots of footage.
Okay. Thank you. Watch out for that tail. Give us a final thought.
A final thought?
Has anything here been... Do you think we'll go, remember in 2015 when we were talking about that time when it was still weird for men to wear dresses?
Well, I was just thinking about strap-ons in the workplace and thinking how disconcerting it would be if my gynecologist was wearing a strap-on.
Okay.
Don't come to my practice in the future then, I'd say, Natasha, because that's going to happen come Tuesday.
Okay, is that how you met? Right, so where do we want to go? This is Talkaoke, the freeform talk show. Maybe we just recap on what we've been talking about so far. We started off talking about some observations about the mostly men with beards wearing dresses. Are you going as well?
We're going.
I was just doing a recap, but I need to get final thoughts. Give a final thought.
I never knew there were so many ways to hug a person.
Okay.
After this.
Okay, well, maybe you need to go to the... I was going to go to the hugging workshop, but I'm... totally put off by the 20-minute hug. To me, 20 seconds seems a bit like a long time.
I was just thinking about that as well, and Ed makes us do an exercise where you look into someone's eyes for 6 minutes. And And it's awkward.
It's awkward.
Really awkward. And I think hugging for 20 minutes would be that awkward. Yeah. 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 So it's the too much. Too much for me.
Okay. Well, we're going to find out, well, maybe we're not going to find out from you, but we're going to find out from the collective. What is there to fear from having a 20-minute hug with a stranger?
Smell.
Okay. Anyway, let's just get another quick round of names. We've got some new faces at Talkaoke. I'll just explain what that you've heard this already. This is Talkaoke. It's a freeform talk show. Talk about whatever you want to talk about. So far we've talked about the phenomenon of cross-dressing. Are we reaching a tipping point? Should women wear strap-ons in the workplace to get more respect? All that kind of thing. A little bit about hugging workshops and nipple tassel workshops. And there we're kind of like... I wouldn't say we've really got a thread. We're a little bit confused, so maybe we need a bit of new direction. My name's Mikey. Let's find out who we've got around the edge of the table. What's your name?
Kiko.
And?
Dan.
And?
Tilda.
And?
Nancy.
Yeah.
Ada.
Sinead.
And Ed.
Still Ed
after all these years. So where do we want to take this conversation? Do we want to revisit some of these subjects? Do we want to move on afresh? It's kind of up to you.
I want to talk about Shambala.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What do you want to say?
Right, okay. So we've got quite a few things to say. I think it's amazing environmentally, like practice-wise. They are doing really, really well. I just want to say positive things.
Okay. We're going to send this bit to the Shambala people.
I love the fact that they have disabled ramps into all the stages.
Right.
That's sick.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really
okay.
good.
Okay.
Because I saw a guy in a wheelchair and I was like, oh man, that sucks. You can't like, you know, might not get in, but now I can. Sorted. It's great.
Okay. Anything else about Shambala?
What I like is I haven't seen one security guard anywhere. There's literally just like free roaming. Like,
Everyone just trusts each other so much. Okay. Like, there's no one about to police anything.
Strong trust, no police. Anything about, well, we're talking about Shambala, just generally seems to be giving a big up. Anything good to say about Shambala this side?
Well, as soon as I got here, I got a hug from the security guard.
You got a hug?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's pretty nice.
Was that in the hug workshop?
No, it was literally, I was just coming in going, hey, can I get a wristband? And he went, yeah, sure, and we got a hug. So it was okay. Just like the love of people.
How did you rate that hug? Was it a good hug? Was it
okay? Definitely a 9.5 out of 10.
Do you think he'd been... Do you think he'd been to the hug workshop?
He definitely had some experience in hugging. I don't know whether he'd been at the workshop, but he definitely had some experience in hugging.
Maybe he has a natural talent.
Yeah,
okay.
Natural born hugger. Okay. I don't know.
Okay, maybe so. I mean, maybe security and police. Actually, I was in a park in Bermondsey yesterday, and we were all talking about police. But police never give hugs out, do they?
No.
You know, last time I was at Shambala, which is why I thought it was those chaps over there, it was 2 years ago, there was the Wave Police Van.
Yeah.
What were they called? They were amazing. And basically, this police rave unit. So basically, these people drive around, well, it looks like a police van, all dressed up as police. You think they are police. But they're playing rave, and it's basically, they trot around. I hope they are this year. They're amazing. And they're actually very really good music. We basically follow them around the whole festival going, whoop, whoop. Call the police.
Okay. I mean, should police be a bit more like that? Should they be a bit more like warm and giving and
cuddly
or rave inducing?
They had the same at Notting Hill. Like, they had actually legit policemen like dancing around, and like there was one grinding like with some woman. It was just really funny. That was a video of it somewhere. I think it was last year.
And you think this is the way the police should be going?
I think it should. Yeah, they should be more down to earth.
Yeah. What's that?
You definitely have more respect for a police if it's going to be more chilled and dancing and get with the, you know, understand your mentality.
Okay.
While you're there.
At your level.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At your level.
Okay.
They're allowed to sort of like relax a bit more into it and get into it. Was they should do that every day because people would like them more.
Okay. Yeah.
I saw a program of the police at Notting Hill Carnival or something, and the boss man was saying to all of his little policemen, like,
little man.
Was he bigger than the rest of them, or was he just like
just
more
hierarchy,
more grandeur?
But he was saying he was saying like smile, put the gun away, like just chill out and like enjoy it. So like
yeah,
or do they have guns? They don't have guns. Batons or whatever.
Yeah, put your weapons away.
Put your weapons away, yeah, and smile and enjoy it.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, yeah. back yeah. Come full circle. That wasn't. Didn't take very long, did it?
Conversation will always end up in a dildo.
I mean, do you think the police? Do you think people?
Something always ends up in a dildo.
Would people?
Should police wear dildos?
Would police have more respect if they had a mahogany dildo?
Yeah. Instead of a dildo, like a big black dildo, instead of like that instead, that would be more respectful. Yeah.
Okay.
You know, you'd understand, like your level again. You know.
Okay.
I'd much rather be like battened with a dildo than a baton.
So police, okay, this is police should have dildos instead of batons. Will it be like a telescopic dildo or would it just be a straightforward?
Right, wow.
It would probably scare off quite a few of the men if it was like massive and daunting. They'd be like, no, it's outdoing me, so they'd run away. Or,
so
like,
you think it should be like a very small average dildo?
5.5 inches.
A 5.5 inch dildo. Okay.
Minimum. Yeah.
Okay. So police should be kitted with a...
The crime, the bigger the dildo.
Okay. Well, this is the question. Should it be a telescopic dildo? Hello, come and get involved in this. We're talking about police work. What's that? Yeah, should police have 5.5 inch dildos instead of truncheons? Come and join the conversation. That's what we're talking about. I can't hear. Can you hear from over there? I can't hear. Come over here. So that's what we're talking about. We've got Sinead, we've got Ada, and
Nancy,
and Tilda, Dan, and Kiga, and I'm Mikey. And this is Talkaoke, and we're talking about police with dildos. Okay, but is that a kind of like, like full stop of a conversation?
Is it supposed to be like, what colour? Black?
Oh.
Or like, or we're going like pink.
Okay.
Code red.
Okay, like a flashing blue dildo.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
It's a red dildo.
Yeah.
Color coded.
So you know.
Okay, hello, this is Talkaoke. Come and take a seat. Should police, instead of truncheons, have 5.5 inch dildos? Instead of truncheons, color-coded for the type of operation they are undertaking.
Yes.
That's what we're talking about at the moment. What's that?
Yes. Just yes. Straight answer.
Yeah. Okay.
It started somewhere completely different.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. Have we done police with dildos? Where do we want to move on to? Do we want to talk about dildos? Do we want to talk about police? Do we want to talk about the kind of the aesthetic of the police? I mean, we talked a lot about
the... Do you use the uniform?
Well, I don't know. Do you think they should?
Well, go with full fetish with the dildo.
Dresses. Should they be wearing dresses?
Should police be actually wearing dresses?
That's actually... Yeah. Yeah, they'd be able to run faster, I think. Their legs are free.
Yeah.
So they'd be able to...
Oh, but would it be like a WPC sort of dress?
What's that? Sorry?
Should policemen wear a WPC kind of like Juliet Bravo kind of...
Checkered, like white and black.
I was old enough to remember when the Bill first came out, and I'm sure they used to wear skirts. Do you remember?
Yeah.
That one with the short blonde hair, what was her face? Officer, what was the name? They definitely had skirts. I don't even see police officers wearing skirts.
Should the male police officers be wearing skirts as well? Would that help?
Condescending walk a lot better as well. Yeah. You know that.
What's a condescending walk?
I think it's sort of like. Is it
like
it was at the end of the bill, remember?
Oh, yeah.
Condescending walk.
Just looking
up to you like.
What kind of bill did you want?
Yeah.
What were you on at the time?
Okay, that's interesting. I don't really remember.
That's why you
were. Yeah. So it wasn't the police doing that. Yeah.
It wasn't the police. Well, it was
Okay. So. Okay.
Special forces.
Okay. Special. There's certainly some special forces at work today. Come and have a seat. You can lean your bike up against one of these chairs. Where do we want to take this conversation? It's kind of up to you. That's the whole way Talkaoke works. Come and join him. We're kind of talking about you anyway.
Yeah.
Not you personally, you in general.
You and your people.
Yeah, you and your people. Men wearing dresses. Are we at a tipping point? Was kind of an earlier conversation. And we've been talking about should the police actually be wearing dresses to soften... Police men be wearing dresses to soften their look. That's what we're talking. Come and get involved. We've got Keegan, we've got Dan, we have got Tilda, we have got Nancy, we've got Ada, we've got Sinead, and what's your name?
Will.
Will, my name's Mikey, what's your name?
Shane.
And?
Michael.
Michael.
Michael and Michael.
Michael and Mikey. What do you think about this? Do you think the police have got their look wrong, essentially? Are they looking a bit too formal?
I think they do look quite serious.
Yeah.
And they definitely need something to liven it up.
Yeah.
Are dresses the right answer?
Have you got other ideas?
Slinkies, I think.
Do you think should be the official police hat?
Yeah, if policemen wore... If they had a load of slinkies on their hats, I feel like people would smile at them a little bit more.
Okay. Yeah. I mean... Yeah. So would it depend on their ranks, how many slinkies they had, or yeah
I guess so, yeah, it would be, yeah.
So you're effectively wearing like a sergeant's hat.
Oh yeah. And
that many slinkies,
and with a bit of surveillance on it as well.
Okay, cause surveillance slinky. What do people think about the surveillance culture that we're in? Look, there's a camera there watching us. Fuck off. again.
Performers that are the problem.
It's what?
Maybe it's us as the performers that are the problem.
But we actually want to be on camera.
Well, no, we're not performing as well. We, you know, give more entertainment.
Okay.
What's there to watch?
Okay, there's nothing.
You're talking about surveillance more generally, aren't you? I mean...
Well, I'm just talking anything. I'm trying to get a conversation started. No. Are you thinking of surveillance more generally?
Yeah, I mean, practically everything you do these days is...
Watched over?
Could be, yeah.
Yeah.
Most of that information's rubbish.
Yeah.
But there's any number of links that authorities could make with all that data. So it's going to be pretty soon that we're going to have effectively data held in one place, in a central government office, and they will have a lot of information.
They'll know everything about everybody.
Yeah, it'll all be pieced together eventually through the NHS and various other organisations.
How Apple have got everyone's fingerprint now. You know, stuff like that. So.
Have they? They haven't got my fingerprint.
Well, they haven't got mine either, but... Yeah.
I've got some people.
You've got an iPhone 5.
Yeah. Okay, are we worried about Apple, Google, the government? Are you worried about the government knowing so much about you? No, you're not bothered. You are worried. Come over here. I can't hear him from over there.
He says he's worried, but he doesn't look worried.
He doesn't look that worried.
That's the thing.
Yeah. I mean... Well,
annoying is that your information is used for consumerist purposes, really. The information that they have effectively just makes it easier to sell to you.
Right.
I was in IKEA the other week, and I didn't expect a couple of days later a sort of handwritten, personalised letter thanking me for my business and things like that. So they clearly have that ability to sort of track you and therefore sell you more and more stuff.
Right. Was it a proper handwritten letter, or was it
like... was one of those ridiculous handwritten letters in the type sort of thing. Whatever the letter was, it was made to seem really friendly and pleasant and everything like that. My point is that it was a way of encouraging further sales just through information.
What were you buying at IKEA?
A bed, as happened.
A bed.
But, you know.
Yeah.
No dildos on it. But,
That's not a real bed if it doesn't have dildos on it.
I mean,
like, yeah. Offsprings, did it have springs on it?
Maybe that was why they were writing to you in a friendly way.
What letter did they write? Was it like a B or like an H?
I mean, how do they start off? Did they,
like, what? Did it look really nice? Did they, like...
I thought this was a serious matter.
You think, well, I mean, we can... That's the thing.
In the sense that information will be used to will be used to maximise marketing to you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that is an issue. And if you want to ignore that kind of issue, you're ignoring the whole sort of notion of intense consumerism.
Okay. Are people worried about being marketed to? Do they feel they're kind of like over...
It's not all bad.
Yeah? Yeah, go, okay.
Why not? At the end of the day, you're going to be bombarded with adverts all the time.
Yeah.
And before they tracked all your data, you got adverts that were completely irrelevant, things that you would never be interested in, and it's got just a complete distraction.
Since
they've started carrying data, the adverts I'm finding are more targeted, and I'm actually finding the adverts sometimes interesting, and I click on them.
What sort of adverts do you like?
Technology things. Yeah. I'm a computer programmer, so it's also nice when Google remembers what your search words are, because then when you type it in again, you don't have to type the whole thing. It just comes up on a list, and
it's kind of good that Google knows this stuff, because then it can tailor its service to Shane. To Shane, to me, to you.
Because on Facebook, I always get the little things on the side saying like local girls. Like 15 to 18, and that's great.
Yeah. Okay, so Facebook knows. Yeah,
knows. That's really
I get like lose weight. I get lose weight and deal with premature balding. That's what I get.
But I'm obviously searching the wrong thing. Like.
All right. So, what kind of targeted ads are they right for us? Shane says they're right for him. It's technology, but everyone else. It's Dan, isn't it? Yeah, Dan's quite happy with the ads that he gets, but...
I'm not happy. I always get rubbish fashion ones, which I'm not... I went to one website once, and then they bombard you. Mm. Or, like, there's one... Like, you buy something from a website, and then they just constantly bombard you.
Yeah.
And it's like, I'm not interested anymore. It's just, I bought one thing because I ran out of... I needed a spoon, for Christ's sake. I'm not... That was it.
Yeah.
I bought... I'm done. I don't need any more spoons.
Okay. Okay. Everyone needs a spoon.
I mean, I'm questioning the very assumption of being advertised to in the first place. I want to have the choice of whether that information comes to me. You know, if I'm online, I'd like to have a system where I don't have to have any adverts at all. You know, we have a BBC which doesn't have adverts. But why can't you, I have an internet with no adverts?
Are you more bothered by the adverts or by the fact that they know so much about
bit
you?
Bit of both. Okay. I think one of them is a bit spooky. I mean, when you go online, and I'm an older generation, so for me it's still pretty bizarre sort of thing, the internet.
Yeah.
The fact that it can kind of read your mind a little bit, I find a bit weird.
Okay. So it's reading your mind, does it know more about you than you know about yourself? You're a new face to the table. We're basically talking about, are you worried about the fact that Google knows everything about your stuff, Apple, or that maybe it's the government? Are we worried about these things? Is it kind of useful and helpful, or is it a bit of both?
I think another thing to do with it is impatience. Just because when you're on these websites and they ask you to sign in or whatever, there's an option to put sign in with Facebook, and that's people purely press that because they can't be bothered to type in their information. And there they can write NA, like not applicable or whatever, but because they just want to get straight to their site, they want to see what's available, they just press sign in with Facebook. And then they have all of your details, your location, your age, other things that if you actually think about it, you might not want to provide.
Okay.
You can't use Facebook anyway. And again, as a sort of, I'm trying to remain an outsider to the internet because it's not so much part of an older generation's culture. The thing about Facebook is that you are in effect the product.
Yeah.
You don't know it. You think you've got this sort of online life, but what you are is just some sort of piece of data that is useful to them. It feels free. It feels very liberal and interesting, but it isn't. It's really just a way of targeting you.
Okay, let's ask people, how does it feel to be a product? Do you feel like a product? How does it feel? I'm going to ask this person, because even I said, what's your name, first of all?
I'm Dan.
Dan, that's easy. Do you feel like a product?
Not particularly, no.
No? I mean, you agree with Will that you are a product?
With Facebook specifically, I would agree, yeah. But I'm not on Facebook, so I don't.
Okay, so you're not on Facebook, you're not bothered with that stuff. Are you a product? How does it feel to be a product? Maybe we could weave this into...
It's a fair deal. You're getting a free service.
Yeah? You think it's all right?
In exchange, you give up some of your private information. I think what the problem is you can't control that. Once you've given it to them, it's a one-way deal. You can't pull it back again afterwards. A solution would be to implement something where you had revocable information, where you had a way to track everyone else who has your information and withdraw it from them later.
Okay, so
they misbehave with that. And it needs to be secure. Has anyone heard of AshleyMadison.com?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so basically we're talking about, do you feel like are you a product? That's what we're talking about. Are you a product? We're always saying Facebook turns you into a product. As soon as you click onto Facebook, you're being sold to or advertise your information. You're basically being pimped out there, basically.
It looks like you're free. You know, it looks like it's an individual choice to represent yourself on Facebook. It feels very free and liberating. I can say what the fuck I like on Facebook, but in fact there is a strong need for information which you're giving freely.
Okay, all right.
And what is it being used for? That's the main thing that I'm never quite clear on. What could you do with this information?
Okay.
And you know.
Okay. Well, just very simply, the fact that adverts are tailored to you on Facebook is because they use your information.
But Shane says he doesn't mind that because it's kind of useful, because he wants to know about technology products. He works in IT. He's a computer programmer, in fact. So it's quite useful to get these tailored adverts.
What about, I suppose, an IT magazine's, or you know, a magazine to get these products is a more focused way where you get some actual kind of.
So you think you should be reading an IT magazine? You know. Yeah.
I think if you want to do things, this isn't working anymore.
No, isn't it? Oh, yeah, this is probably me. No, it should go again.
If you want to do anything that's potentially outside the law, and you're worried about your information being private, then just conduct those activities under an alter ego, like create a separate persona.
Yeah, so you think you should have more than one personality on Facebook. Okay.
So you have your public persona and you share the information you're willing to let everyone have, and then you have a different persona where you keep things more private.
Okay, so you've got like a covert persona.
I just wouldn't trust the way that information is used later. We don't know how that information is used later and how it is being assembled and what sort of what sort of deductions they're making from our behavior.
Do you think they can work out that you're actually that person, you're Mr. X as well as Will?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is what we're talking about. This is Talkaoke, it's a freeform talk show. You can talk about any old crap. And then we are talking about, are we worried about Facebook, Google knowing more about us than we know about us? Are we worried about them, us, we become the product? And we're like the sheep in the abattoir, so to speak.
How would that happen? How would they know more about us than we do?
Okay. Okay, so this is getting too hot now. This is getting too hot. Come on and take a seat. Have you got a final thought, Shane? Do you think they know more about us than we know about us, or do you think that's...
No, of course they don't. They have to piece things together from little tiny bits and pieces. You know about yourself, obviously, more than anyone else can. But, just read the terms and conditions.
Who reads the terms and conditions?
Ridiculous thing to say.
We only know about us what we
want them to know what we give them about us.
Okay.
So they could know something that wasn't even true. That wouldn't mean that they know us more than we do.
Okay, so you can potentially,
So my mate, he's Jewish, and he had a girlfriend for a long time. Mm. I don't know, this is like probably a conspiracy theory, I don't know, but he broke up with his girlfriend, and he didn't have like a status on Facebook or anything that said like his relationship was over.
Yeah.
But like 2 days later, he started to get lots of adverts on his Facebook page for J-Swipe, which is like, it's like Tinder for Jewish people.
Really?
Yeah.
So they knew,
Yeah, they somehow like had some algorithm that worked it out.
Wow. Yeah. Wow, that's freaky and funny, but a bit scary.
Even though he didn't update his status.
Okay, no status update. So we say we only give it the information we want to give it, but it actually works this stuff out. What's that?
I wasn't listening.
What? Okay, well, don't worry. That's what I'm here for. Basically, okay, give us a... Oh, hang on a sec. I'm just going to have a final thought from these people. Give us a final thought.
Final thoughts. So on the Facebook front, I'm a bit concerned because I've put about 3,000 beautiful pictures on their website, and what happens when they decide that they just want to delete them all? All of my beautiful pictures have gone, so I can print them all out when I get home now.
Okay.
After thinking about all of this.
That's going to be a lot of ink cartridges.
Yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to say, because you complimented me on my shirt, but I really like your shirt as well.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Yeah. Anyway, final thought.
Going back to the cross-dressing stuff, I'm going to embrace that a little bit more at festivals, I think.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks.
What's your motive?
My motive? Just us guys being so keen for it, just chatting about it earlier.
Yeah.
It's more reasonable than...
You can show that you're in touch with your entire sexuality.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay.
Totally.
Okay. So, more cross... Earlier on we were talking about, are we at a tipping point with cross-dressing? Is it going to become mainstream? Final thought, Keegan?
Definitely going to dress myself in a glitter beard now.
Glitter beard. What we were talking about earlier on, but right now we're talking about... It's kind of up to you. We could go back. Come have a seat. We could go back to that. It's kind of up to you. My job in the middle was just simply to move the microphone around, make sure people... What's your name again?
Do you get twisted up in that thing?
No, because I'm used to... I don't spin all the way around. But you didn't hear what... what's it? Alon was saying. Alon's friend basically broke up with his girlfriend, and then like 2 days later Facebook was advertising a Jewish dating... the friend was Jewish, so it got that right, and it got the fact that he just split up. He knew, even though he put nothing on Facebook. Facebook knew. How? We don't know how.
I don't know. Yeah, it's probably like a conspiracy, but like they've got crazy algorithms. Like our friend works at Facebook,
right?
And he says the shit that goes down there. Like they just have these people, like these geeky people, who just like work out all these like complex algorithms, mathematics, like based on population kind of patterns, and they can work out what you're likely to be, what your likes are likely to be. Yeah,
it's a bit like those logic problems that no one really understands. Like if Alan is dating Jane, but Bill was dating, you know, and then you can work it all out if you get into the logic.
That's how an algorithm works, you know. It works on the basis that if something is not true, it's something else. So it's a sort of if-then kind of scenario.
Okay, so
you can start reproducing human intelligence pretty soon via artificial intelligence.
Okay,
so Facebook will have the top computers and the top algorithms and all of that.
Right, okay, so it's actually artificial intelligence. It's kind of understanding how we work, how we behave. And so you don't need to tell it all the things about... Yep.
What I'm concerned about is when the computers and the artificial intelligence starts cross-dressing.
Right, okay.
Then I think we really need to worry...
Just to express its sexuality,
About the level that they've got to.
The day.
Okay.
All
right.
Mind is going.
Okay. Whoa. Okay, so are we worried about artificial intelligence? Okay, what's artificial... What is artificial intelligence? Somebody tell... This is like unofficial intelligence,
All intelligence is artificial.
Okay, right.
No, it's created by computers, so effectively you're looking at a computer that is capable of reproducing human thinking. So if you think, that computer can do the same sort of thing. It can even have emotions.
Okay. Can computers have emotions? Can machines have emotions? Will says yes.
What if they get so intelligent that they will kill us, like in the films?
Okay.
What if they start eating us?
Okay, are you worried about that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Actually, I'm more worried about zombies.
Okay. Okay.
Have you seen Humans?
Yeah.
On Channel 4.
Okay, did you enjoy that?
It's a programme called Humans. Yeah. It's about the synthetic humans who are designed to be exactly like humans, but who knows?
I mean,
what's eating us?
Okay.
Is that what
it says? No, right.
What are they doing?
Okay, what?
Zapping us.
Okay, are you worried about robots taking over?
Not really.
No.
I think that we're almost certain to produce an intelligence that will work pretty well. But it'll be benign. Probably, because the way, like, people have seen all these films where the robot takes over, and they probably just won't allow that to happen. If you just don't give it access to the internet.
Okay, so if you create an intelligent machine, please don't put it on the internet. So that's quite a good idea, I think.
I'm scared about nuclear war.
Nuclear war?
I'm scared. Okay.
All you do is just program it not to have emotions of revenge and things like that. You have to just program it fundamentally to be benign to humans, and that's probably what will happen.
So is it about good?
It's going to be like an evolutionary process that creates this artificial intelligence. You won't be able to control it. At some point, like, someone's going
Okay, you're coming back. Alright, well, there's a lot of hays and yays, which is good. It's a festival. Come and have a seat. This is Talkaoke. At the moment, we're talking about, I will say, the whole way Talkaoke works, and some people around the table do know this, is that you can talk about whatever you want to talk about. So far today, we've talked mostly about cross-dressing and the fear of artificial intelligence, and also the question about, will machines ever want to cross-dress? So there's some of the questions that are on the table at the moment, but it's kind of up to you where you want to take this. Let's just get around our names. My name's Mikey. What's your name?
Nadav.
Nadav, yeah.
Will.
Dan.
Alon.
Kathleen. Bex.
Bex. Okay, so where do you want to take this conversation? Are you worried about Facebook knowing more about you than you know about you? Are you right, or Google? What's that?
What about Twitter? Does anyone use Twitter?
Does anyone Twitter? Twitter. I don't think anyone. No one seems to be worried about Twitter, do they?
What I find a bit freaky about Facebook is when it like tells you of like this happened a year ago, so like it plants a memory in your head of like some. Right. You know what happens in your newsfeed of like a year ago this happened, and I'm like, whoa, I've forgotten that.
So are you worried about Facebook taking over your memory in a way?
Yeah, it's a psychological influence on memory.
Okay. Crazy stuff. I mean, would we just be like, I mean, maybe we should be putting this up. Are you worried about Facebook taking over your life? Come and have a seat. I'm talking to this person leaning against the rose in a sort of semi-interested way. I'm making them interested. That's my job, basically. So we've got Bex, we've got Kathleen, we've got Alan, we've got Dan, we've got Will and Nadal.
Nadav.
What's it?
Nadav with a V.
Nadav, sorry. Am I Mikey? What's your name?
Tiger Lily.
Tiger Lily, welcome. Are you worried about Facebook or artificial intelligence in general taking over your life? Your friend, Alon's friend, didn't say anything about splitting up with his girlfriend. Facebook knew and started to get him to sell adverts about dating sites. How weird, how spooky is that? Are we worried about this, or is this just kind of helpful? Especially if you're interested in dating, just like this cross-dressing phenomenon seems to be very helpful for people dating. But are we worried about it? Anyway, that was just a callback to an earlier thing.
Maybe you could invent robotic clothes that change from kind of. Like male clothes to like female style clothes, you know, just a switch of a, you know, they just transform.
Okay.
You know, maybe that's the future for, you know.
Okay, so almost
sort of clothing, you know.
Wearable, like cross-dress in an instant. Will that be the future? We're combining the cross-dressing conversation with the technology conversation. Will cross-dressing be just, will it happen at the touch of a button in the future? There'll be no need for extravagant makeup or
replace the surgery.
What do people think? Can that happen?
I'm gonna play the devil's advocate,
yeah,
and use that as an example of that actual way that you can be empowered,
right,
by Facebook to, yeah, reinvent yourself or invent yourself publicly, mm, in any way you like. And the generation of sort of self-made journalists that,
right,
we are,
yeah,
that is a big part of my life. You know, I represent musicians, and they
they write articles about themselves or somebody else.
Well, I promote.
Yeah.
So obviously Facebook is the biggest free PR tool,
right,
and most efficient PR tool ever to exist. It doesn't cost you anything.
Right.
I mean, you can pay for it.
So Facebook is good.
I'm saying it can be good. It's
yeah,
it only knows what you show it, and actually it's up to you how you put yourself out there.
Okay.
Thanks, sorry. That's all very well and good, Tiger Lily, now that we know how much data Facebook is collecting, but we've already all been using it for seven or eight years, just splurging our
everything.
Whole lives. Yeah, yeah, just you know, confessing everything to Facebook, and or, you know, even now, people who are maybe a slightly younger generation maybe are aware of how all their data is taken, but they're young, they don't care, right? They just want to go and have fun and do stuff, yeah, online, but then it'll catch up to you.
Okay, so
why be precious about your data? And why be precious?
Are we too precious about our data? It's just data. It's just zeros, ones.
I like
who this. Cares? Yeah, I like this. Who cares if I like that picture of somebody with a wig on? Who cares? It's just data. Zeros and ones.
Well, I think it's in its infancy as well,
yeah,
like we've only had this for a few years. It's developed massively, but we're still like,
mm,
even with just the internet, we're still, mm, just kids, like,
yeah,
fumbling around
kids
with it
in the play pit basically.
So all this is going to play out. It doesn't have to necessarily play out.
What's your feeling about? Do you agree with Tiger Lily that it's just we're being a bit too precious about just a bit of data?
I think if you focus on your data and the fear of losing it and the fear of other people doing stuff, you lose sight of what the like you say, the tool is that you're actually using, and it's actually quite a powerful thing. Just the concept of Facebook, that,
yeah,
you can connect to somebody, like that's what it's given us, like that we want to connect to people.
I disagree, and again, I'm looking at it from a period, most of my life I never lived with Facebook, so you know, for me it's quite a sort of novel and strange kind of thing.
Do you ever use it as a promotional tool?
No, I don't. But the concerns among psychologists, which is my background, is more to do with It reduces intimacy between people.
Right.
In fact, it's a highly superficial way of just presenting yourself. You're not really interested in other people's behaviour. It's just a tool to self-promote, and it's narcissistic.
Okay. So it's,
you know?
Tiger Lily.
Okay. Well, do you want to know? You go first.
Okay. You.
I was just going to make an observation about Facebook and how our society is becoming individualised, and my friends brought her GoPro, yeah, with her to the festival,
yeah,
on a selfie stick. And isn't it just that's that whole phenomenon is just so weird.
It's
just you go to Machu Picchu or wherever, and then you just get this stick, point it a meter away from you, just point it at yourself, take photos of yourself, put it on Facebook and leave. It's very odd. I don't know. I don't know if it's bad. It's just quite funny.
Do you think is it about narcissism, as Will says?
Yeah, I guess so. It must be.
Because that individualism undermines a kind of social cohesion. Okay, this sounds a bit heavy, but the point is people are less interested about wider social issues if they're only interested in themselves, you know, and that's, I noticed that from festivals.
If being interested in those wider social issues makes you look good on Facebook.
Yeah, makes you look good.
Yeah, because suddenly, yeah.
But again, I wouldn't say it was a sincere thing necessarily. It would be a conscious act of self-promotion, pretending that you like Greenpeace. You know, it's a nonsense. But I notice in festivals over 30, 40 years,
yeah,
back in the day in sort of early 80s, every tent here would be discussing political issues. Every tent, every person would be discussing. And now what you guys are talking about is yourselves, you know? That's how it seems to me.
Right, okay, I see. But can narcissism be a force for political good? Is it maybe like, you know, not trying to reinvent the wheel, maybe narcissism can actually help? No, you say no? Okay.
There were young Egyptian kids saying, "Thank you, Facebook. You enabled us to organise a revolution." That there are uses that Facebook can be put to mobilise social movements that no other platform is able to do, and that the culture of self-promotion, I think Facebook is a product of that and not a cause of it. And another angle is about how advertising has changed as a result of data collection, which is we've stopped responding to push advertising. Big billboards, adverts, we turn them off, we turn them down, we don't see them. And so marketeers now look at the consumer as the first point of call and the product as the final point of call. So they're looking at us and think, what do they want? What are they asking for? Let's create something based on that. So if you put out, well, we want fucking green energy, you know, we want chip oil powered cars that we can afford.
Yeah.
Eventually, those companies are going to have to make it. So I'm saying this, that in every move, in one direction, that you have the polar opposite move.
Okay, hang on a sec, Will. I'm trying to entice this person in. So come and have a seat on the table of chat. You're very welcome. We're talking about technology, Facebook. Is it something to... You come and sit down. I can't hear from again. You're good. Okay. Okay.
Facebook here. Look.
Yeah. Okay. So we. Are you on Facebook?
No.
No. Are you going to be in the future?
Yeah.
What? How old do you think you need to be on Facebook?
12.
Okay. Okay. And I mean, what is Facebook for?
If you don't have a text app, I think it might be for texting and posting photos and videos and stuff.
What sort of photos and videos?
Cool ones that you think other people might like.
Okay, so cool stuff other people might like is very useful for that.
So I think Facebook
Come and sit down.
You can't do that. They're in there listening to...
Okay, all right. It's very confusing.
Yes, Facebook, obviously. Old person.
Because basically we've got Tiger Lily over here who is saying that Facebook is really good for self-promotion, but also it feeds into something that we already have, which is this kind of sense of like me, where am I in the world? But Will is saying it's essentially narcissistic. That means people that like looking at themselves, essentially. And it's bad for everyone else.
If I could possibly interrupt you, actually, it's not about that. Because, like, my kids don't use Facebook because it's, like, passé now.
Yeah.
You know, it's, like,
it's over.
Only the old ones use it. And I use it for photo sharing, you know. So, like, because I have, like, different family around the world. And so, like, you post pictures and it's, like, easy.
Yeah, right.
What program is this on?
This is Talkaoke. We're on the internet. We can be on Facebook.
Are there people watching this?
What's that?
Are there people watching this now?
Are we going to put it on a podcast? We don't get many, many views. It's normally the people that have, or the friends and family of the people that have sat around this table that actually watch.
We got people who tried to crash your camera with a water balloon.
What's that? No, please don't. Please don't. Yeah.
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 Hello.
Yeah.
The last thing is that the worst thing about Facebook for me, because I use it so much for work, and I really have to damage limitation when it comes to getting on there. I have to go straight to what I'm doing and not look at anything else. But it will remove me from my immediate environment in an instant. And that can, I think, will cause issues, be a condition eventually, where you don't actually exist in this world. But I think there are many other online things that do that as well, like Minecraft, World of
Minecraft,
all that stuff. stuff. Okay. It takes you out of your immediate moment and away from people.
But, I mean, is that a good thing or is it a bad thing? Is it a bit of both? Is it undermining our society, as Will says? Let's just quickly get around. We've got a few new faces at the table. So we've got Kathleen, we've got Alan, we've got Dan, we've got Will, we've got Nadav.
Got it.
And what's your name?
Luca.
And?
Rio.
And Tiger Lily. And?
Louis.
Okay, and my name's Mikey. So we're talking about, are these things that you do on a computer like Minecraft and Facebook, are they actually stopping us from talking to each other?
No.
No?
No, because on Minecraft you can talk to chat to people who are on your game.
Yeah, are you a Minecraft player?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you explain Minecraft to me?
Okay. Hang on, one at a time. Hang on a second, we didn't get your name. What's your name? Okay, we'll come back to you. Tell us about Minecraft.
Minecraft is basically a game where you can download it you can get it on Xbox, PlayStation, PC.
And what do you do in Minecraft?
And mobile devices. I don't know how much it is, but I know how much it is for the mobile devices.
What do you do on Minecraft? How do you play the game?
Nearly anything. You can build stuff, fight monsters. There are two modes: creative mode, where you can not die, and monsters won't blow up destroy your stuff.
Yeah.
And there's survival, where you can have loads of fun fighting off monsters. And one of the most scariest monsters is called creepers, and they explode!
Okay, right. Are you on Minecraft as well?
Yep.
What mode do you use?
I usually go on creative, and there are quite a few monsters there are. There are creepers, withers, skeletons, zombies.
Right.
Zombie pig bear.
Do you think it's a good way of meeting people, of talking to people on the internet?
Well, you can talk to people and also fight together.
Okay, yeah.
On Minecraft, there are only squared and rectangled.
Right, is that limiting?
There are only squared and
rectangled. Okay.
Webs.
What's that? Come here. Can't hear what you're saying.
Can I just do it inside?
Okay. So we're talking about Minecraft. Are people aware of this Minecraft phenomenon? Do you know about Minecraft?
Unfortunately, I've got to go to another interview, but I just want to, one final thing to say. Thank you to all my esteemed
have
colleagues
here. Have you got a
here.
Final thought?
A final thought on Minecraft is, I think we just have to be very careful. I think Minecraft has lots of potential. Are we talking about Minecraft? Or is it a different game?
Yeah, Minecraft.
It has a lot of potential to be a really powerful tool for mankind. But it could also evolve
what
into...
What about the fact that you can only have squares and rectangles? Are you concerned by that?
Do you think you're going to get taken over by, like, the Minecraft world? So actually this little virtual reality will come into the real reality and...
Well, I didn't catch your name, sorry. Claire. Well, Claire, I like to think of myself as a circle and that I will never be able to be put into a triangle or a rectangle, and so I will always roll away from everything.
Okay, so you're going to roll away as a circle from the square... Escape the square. We're also a circle here, so maybe we'll never fit in.
The main problem with a lot of these video games is not the fact that children learn negative information and become more violent, so on and so forth. The main problem for children is that it makes them less physical.
Right.
And we know that they are spending a lot more time in front of screens than previous generations did, and that has a big impact on future health, obesity, things like that.
Okay.
So it's that, and also it's about whether children are able to make actual judgments in the real world. When you're a kid, you need to take a few little risks, but when you're on a computer game, you're not doing any such thing. You're just playing a game.
Okay, so it's that creative mode where if you get killed, it doesn't matter.
And you can't die on creative, but...
Do you think you're not spending enough time outdoors, experiencing the fresh air and the grass?
No.
You could be doing real mining.
Minecraft... I can't think... Minecraft, you can build anything. You can build a mansion and stuff.
What's the best thing you built on Minecraft so far?
Well, I built a castle and an underground base in a well, but I had to delete that. But I had to delete the world they were on.
Oh dear.
And also, there's a really awesome thing you can do on survival mode.
Okay.
You can get you can get stuff.
But what about playing in the outdoors?
I do that as well?
I do that as well.
Half the time I'm playing Minecraft and half the time I'm outside.
Hang on a sec. What we're talking about... Oh, we've lost them now. What we're talking about is... Is Minecraft stopping kids from getting outside and doing proper mining? Should they be actually doing real mining like they did in Victorian times? Because they're smaller, they can get into those very small seams.
Minecraft, you can also grab stuff and do Hunger Games and fight other people.
Does it make you want to do real mining?
Too dangerous. I would get grounded for life.
Okay. Yep.
I'd like to ask the kids, what do you think about the festival? Like, how does this compare to, like, normal life?
Here.
You talk a lot.
Okay, let me just... I just feel like we're sort of losing a bit of coherence, so back to the middle, back to me, look at me. So we're talking about is this festival any good for young people, for kids? What do people think?
It's great. There's kids feel. There's Helter Skelter. What that is?
Yeah, what?
That thing over
Ferris
there.
Wheel.
The Ferris wheel. And there's also a spinny. There's also a spinny swing.
Okay, so you're having a good time.
Yeah, I've also been to a lot of other festivals. I've been to.
Is there a Minecraft booth at this festival?
Do not know.
Do you think there should be Minecraft at the festival?
Yeah, and there's Minecraft gaming you can do called Minecoin.
Okay, should there
and
be...
And also...
What, here at the festival, there is Minecraft?
No.
Okay.
But at places, also...
Okay, maybe next year, maybe... Okay, I just want to say to the Shambala organisers are watching this, we need Minecraft next year at the festival. Think about that. Okay, I'm just going to go around because I've been asked by Kathleen to ask everyone... have you enjoyed the festival? And what's been the highlight?
Yes.
What's been the best
and
thing?
And the TNT that is... You can get TNT on Minecraft and it's pooping.
Okay, back to this again. This happened in 2012. Anyway, what's been the best thing about the festival?
Mini golf so far.
Mini golf. Do you think they should have Minecraft at the festival?
Yeah.
Okay, so everyone is saying there should be Minecraft actually at this festival. There could be a little booth or something where people can get on and play a bit of Minecraft.
Should we do it? Yeah. Should we do like proper Minecraft? Big, like, perspective or life size for
real
kids.
Life.
But like a whole world, like fence off a whole bit and get thousands of them in there.
Lots of square
and
blocks.
And foam at pickaxe.
So Minecraft in the real world?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, how would that...
No miners, though.
From a psychologist's point of view, would that work for you?
Minecraft in the real world?
Yeah.
I'm half on safety, though, because there would be too much building.
Well, it would feel real, so it would be effectively a virtual reality.
Would that help adults and older people understand what Minecraft was about?
Well, yeah, of course it would. But
it
would also be, again, a bit spooky, because we'd start getting people who got so lost in the game that they started to lose their identity. So there's a room for sort of mental health issues if you can't... separate that virtual reality from reality.
Okay, can you have too much Minecraft? Can you get lost in the game? That's what Will's saying, you can actually get lost in the game.
Thousands of things.
Yeah. Have you ever got lost in Minecraft?
Never.
Okay, so you're okay.
If you can fly.
Okay. Can you have too much Minecraft?
No, because the world you make never ends. I forgot what I was going to say.
Okay, well, that's not too much of a problem.
On the mic, we've just had an idea, actually.
Yeah.
Minecraft Hang using on. Foam blocks.
Okay. Minecraft is in favour. Get a final thought from these people.
I think we can learn from the kids.
Okay.
Yeah.
Learn what?
I think games can be really useful in terms of, like, cognitive...
Do you like the idea of foam blocks and have a real-world Minecraft?
Yeah, I like it. Bring it on.
I think you're right. I like the wisdom of children is key. Like that's where the future is.
Okay. I'd like to counter that point by saying that the wisdom of children is a load of absolute tosh.
Yeah.
These children have no brains whatsoever. I know because I sired two of them. Frankly, they're pointless.
Yeah.
They're serving me no help other than greyer hairs, a bigger beer belly, more worry, and a slight worrying heart murmur.
He's lying.
Okay.
He is so lying.
Okay.
Oh, no. And also, can we end this? Can we make the credits Minecrafty at the end?
No.
Okay, well, I'm going to ask Rick, but I've got the feeling it's going to say it's going to take too much work.
What are we doing here?
This is Talkaoke, it's a free-form talk show. We were talking about the dangers of the internet. Does Facebook know too much about us? Then we moved on to Minecraft, which is more popular. And we're talking about, is Minecraft a force for good or evil? And that's where we are right now, basically.
Just change that perspective of, like, bringing Minecraft into the world in, like, massive, like, sort of...
You think it's a good idea?
Yeah, well, only because my fellow people have decided if we bring it in massive, like, polystyrene blocks, it's not going to hurt anyone. And then you bring your virtual world of your head of computer into the reality.
I think it'd be a really good idea. We're Shambala people, if you're listening... we will do it. We will make it happen if you just give us some money. Okay. Yeah.
I just remembered what I was going to say.
Yeah.
I've been to a lot of other festivals.
Yeah.
I've been to Maui Wowie, which is near Bungie.
Why is it called Maui Wowie?
Do not know.
Yeah.
I've been to another festival called Glastonbury.
Yeah. Why is it called Glastonbury?
Because it's near Glastonbury.
Because it's near a place called Glastonbury.
Right, right, okay, that makes more sense.
And
is Maui Wowie near a place called Maui?
No.
Okay.
It's near a place called Bungie.
Yeah, anyway, you've been to a lot of festivals, and...
Do you go to Glastonbury?
What's that?
Do you...
We haven't been to Glastonbury for approximately 18 years.
Are you going to bring this TV show to Glastonbury soon?
Maybe, it depends on negotiations, you know what I mean?
I really want you to bring it.
What were you saying about this festival? Because you said, I've been to many festivals such as Glastonbury, Maui Wowie, and what was he going to say?
That was what I was going to say.
Okay, but what do you think? Do you think this is better than Glastonbury, worse than Glastonbury?
I would say it's a bit worse than Glastonbury, but I think they're both the same, actually, because Glastonbury, because it's got a whole field of kids stuff, and here...
Yeah.
We just haven't taken you there yet.
Oh, yeah, I know. I forgot, yeah.
Okay, right. I mean, what a bit...
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure.
Okay,
thank you.
Have you got a final thought?
I do have a final thought for the day. What if all pigs only had nipples instead of legs?
Come on.
Okay, well, maybe that may be a reality. Down to... Any final thoughts? Final thought?
Well... Maybe do the credits Minecraft-like.
Okay, do the credits in the Minecraft fashion, Rick. You heard it.
Yeah.
Any final thought? You need to keep the... Don't take the chair away. We need that for potential future punters.
Talk about festivals.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Festivals are fascinating places.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. You were saying, a final thought?
Well, I really want festivals to... I want Minecraft to be in this festival. It's been a pleasure meeting you.
Okay, it's been a pleasure. Thank you.
Are you going to be here tomorrow?
We'll be here tomorrow. We'll be talking about something completely different. Right now, we're talking about festivals. Will's been to a lot of festivals since the 1980s, he said earlier on. Thank you. Thank you.
Good chatting with you. Thanks.
So we're talking about festival. Actually, we need to.
I might download it on my phone.
Well, Minecraft.
$4.99.
$4.99. We're gonna download it too.
I think.
No worries, but I'll keep the
festivals
bottle.
Are fascinating places, and they are changing. I've always been absolutely fascinated by particularly the way they've changed over the decades. You have to have gone to, say, 40 festivals to know what I'm talking about, and
right.
maybe you're in the same sort of boat.
I don't think I've been to 40 festivals. I've been to quite a few festivals, but I'd quite like to hear your kind of perception on how they've changed. And does that reflect... a greater change within society.
It's it, what I'd notice above all,
yeah,
and this does sound a bit pompous of me, but what I notice above all is that people are more kind of seeking, pleasure-seeking all the time. It's purely hedonism. It's yeah. purely dancing at night. It's purely sex. It's purely this, that, and the other.
Right.
Which very rarely happens at festivals anyway. I just want to tell people that.
Yeah.
I think there's about must be about one act of sex in the whole festival. That is yeah. my judgment, because it's okay. a smelly, unpleasant act at a festival.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure festivals are not sexy places.
Okay, well, that's a very big question you've just thrown a big question into the ring. It's a shame there's only three of us here right now. Is sex at the festival, is it a real phenomenon? Do people actually have sex at festivals? Is it too dirty? That's what we're talking about right now.
Sex at Shambala before.
Have you?
I have done, yeah. Yeah?
yeah. Was it dirty?
No, not really.
Okay,
no.
Well, there you go.
There's nothing.
It must have been intense.
Yeah.
sorry, I had to throw that one in.
Aside from your pun, that is, tents are just not desirable sexual abodes. You know, they are not bowers of love. They are horrible, sweaty, sort of, you know, dusty interiors,
tent,
you know. Possibly in a yurt or a girt or whatever they're fucking called, you know.
Okay, come and have a seat on Talkaoke. We're needing punters. We're talking about festivals. Have they become too hedonistic now? People are just interested in drinking and sex, of all things. And is it even right to have sex in a tent? That's what we're talking. You say yes. Come and join in. Come and have a seat on the table of chat. This is Talkaoke. So we've got Will, we've got Dan, I'm Mikey, what's your name?
Kirsten,
we're talking about, basically Will's been to at least 40 festivals since the 1980s, and he said they've become more hedonistic and more, let's say more kind of like obsessed with sex, and then he added that sex at a festival isn't even that great because it happens in a tent.
Yeah,
and you don't remember.
Well,
you can't really have a shower. That's what we're talking about.
That's my theory. Festivals are not sexy places.
Okay.
They're fundamentally about kind of people showing off or pretending almost to be sexy, but the reality of the matter is shagging in a tent is usually a bit crap.
Okay. Okay, well let's broaden the field a little bit.
Disagree then. So a tent.
Okay.
A sexy kind of hotel like. Our
tents.
Anywhere can be a sexy place. Anywhere
you just
can
need
be
to
a sexy.
Right
it depends
person.
Who you're with.
Yeah.
Exactly. If you're shagging the right person, it doesn't matter.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. It depends who you're with. It completely
yeah.
depends who you're with, not your surroundings.
Okay. Does it matter that you haven't got proper access to showers and stuff like that?
No.
Wait,
won't.
I'm right next to some showers.
Okay. So you're good. So you have got access to showers. Does that make your tent more sexy?
Yeah. It puts it up a
okay.
notch or two. Yeah.
Or after.
Both.
Wow. Amazing. Amazing. That must take you at least 2 hours in those kind of queues. Come and have a seat on the table of chat. This is Talkaoke.
Inappropriate.
There's no age limit here on Talkaoke. We like a diversity of ages, in fact. I'm wondering what's going on here.
Bicycle bingo.
What is it?
Bicycle bingo.
Is that what's going on?
They've all come out the tent.
Yeah.
They've all come out the tent. And this guy in the middle is getting them to do loads of strange things, and everybody's just doing it.
Right. What are they doing?
So Amelia and Tessa were doing. What are they doing, girls? Do you know what they're doing?
What are they doing, Tessa?
Do you remember?
What are they doing?
What did he ask them to do?
I don't know.
I don't know what they're doing either.
It's a bit crazy.
So what we're talking about, are festivals concentrating on the right things? Do you enjoy coming to this festival?
Yeah.
Do you enjoy coming?
Yes.
What do you enjoy? Are you here with your mum?
I'm her mum.
I've been here before.
Okay. Did you have fun?
Yes.
Do you think that your mum, like, is? Do you think she has a nice time at the festival?
Yeah.
What's she like doing most?
I don't know.
You don't know. What do you like doing most?
Chilling out and
yeah.
just watching.
I mean,
I'm not bothered about going to anywhere in particular. It's just sort of
yeah.
walking around and stopping where you want to stop, and there's always just stuff to look at and being with
spending time with your friends and family.
Okay, so it's kind of, I mean, do you agree with Will that the festivals have become more hedonistic, that it's more about just self-gratification and less about
This isn't like that though, because everyone's here to have a good time for themselves, but you have more fun when other people around you, when you can see other people enjoying themselves.
Well, all I'd say is that...
Whoops, uh-oh, first spillage of the day.
If you went to festivals in the early 80s, and again it sounds a bit pompous, they were more serious places because there was a lot more political discussion, and that it was genuinely about changing the world for the better, you know, and this place isn't about changing the world for the better, it's a sort of playground, and that's not the same as where there are large groups of people who have ideas and principles and things like that. So all of that's been lost sight of.
Yeah. Okay.
There are so many different types of festivals now, though.
Yeah.
So, do you know what I mean?
I can't find any ones that are that have a serious edge to
political
them.
Edge.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what festivals were all about originally, wasn't it? And I do agree with you that, like, festivals, like everything else in this world, has become just commercially driven, and it's about the media and about the look, and it's about it's the thing to do.
But
and
I mean,
it's
is this festival commercially driven?
Yeah, of course it is. Of course it is.
If you look in any magazines, it's always like holiday fashion, festival fashion, and you're like, you know, like, is it Coachella in the States? It's just a fashion show, isn't it, really? Celebrities.
At root, it's a highly commercialised activity, this. What it has done is made some very wealthy landowners, who are wealthy to begin with, it's revitalised their difficulties with tax and things like that. Because the guy over there clearly is making some financial benefit out of this.
Okay.
He's wealthy already, but in a very real sense, there is a it's an unequal thing. It's like there is a sort of lord looking down on the minions, and he's a sort of allowed them onto his land temporarily.
Okay, so you feel like there's a political edge. What do you think? Is there a political edge to this festival? Do you think this has got an edge?
No.
No? Has it got an edge?
Yes.
Yes?
No.
Okay, so some say yes, some say no. Is there enough of a political edge? I mean, it's interesting, when we were talking about, like, cross-dressing and mahogany strap-ons, we had loads of people around the table. When we started talking about Facebook and Google, is the government watching you, and everybody left. So maybe there is a...
That's indicative. That's exactly what I'm talking about. The fact is, people kind of want to be infantilized. They want to just think of nothing and just get pissed as farts. They want to live in a bubble. You know, they don't want to live in reality.
So let's go around the table. Yeah,
let's bubble temporarily. You know, I like being in a bubble sort of for the weekend, but I know what's going on outside, but it's just a bit of escapism.
On that point, so everybody in the early 80s, none of them were taking drugs or drinking, so it might be more political, but yeah, that's what I mean.
They were having a good time. Hang on a sec, I'm going to go around the table with this one. Are we living in a bubble now? What do you think, Dan?
I think there's something to be said for exploring playing. I think playing is a... like, it's a thing that we don't often get to do in a different world from where we lived, you know, 40 years ago.
So can it be political in itself?
So to give adults the opportunity to play, let alone children, I think it's important, and for us to rediscover what it is to be a child and to look at the world and what we actually want out of it, you know.
Okay.
Real danger there of becoming infantilized. Is sort of forgetting that barrier between being an adult and being a child. And I'm not saying being an adult is the best thing since sliced bread. It isn't. Being an adult is actually quite a hard thing. Yeah? So to kind of pretend that you aren't an adult is in some ways a bit disingenuous, I think.
Okay, so this is Talkaoke. We're talking about... come and have a seat. We've got Will, we've got Dan, we've got... What's your name?
Tessa.
And...
Amelia.
And...
Poppy.
And what's your name? Come and sit down.
Kimberly, but I don't need to sit down.
Why?
I lose my mate, the Fox.
Fox, come back here, Mr. Fox. We're basically, has this festival lost its political edge, or is the playfulness of the festival the very politicalness and a kind of political act in itself, or is it just adults pretending to be children, and should they be doing that?
I personally think it's a, I mean, it's actually my first time here, but I think that what's wonderful about it is it allows people to, I don't know, open their minds a little bit and help them discuss things they wouldn't necessarily discuss, especially people that are particularly have certain strong political
beliefs.
So
you don't think it's lost its political edge then?
Well, I've never been before, but personally, but I mean, I've just got here, and I mean, the only things I've been debating with and talking about with people are political issues.
Right, okay, so maybe not. Okay.
Actually, someone from Greenpeace, and she's like, you know, coming up with really great contacts and different ideas. Here.
So you don't think it's lost it? I mean, what about this question of playfulness? I mean, do you think adults should play too as well as kids? No?
No.
Do you think adults should play too as well as kids?
Yeah.
Yes?
No.
No, okay, so two no's and one yes. Should adults be playful as children? That's what we're talking about. Come and join in. Yeah, we can watch from them, and it makes me look more busy, and then more people will come, and they might say something interesting. So come and sit down, come closer. Should adults be as playful as children? Some people say yes, some people say no. You think it's infantilizing. What's wrong with being a little bit more childlike?
You can be childlike, of course you can, and you should be childlike, but at the same time, it's very easy to sort of become almost addicted on that childlike behaviour, and I suppose sort of forget that you are an adult, and an adult still has very real responsibilities, you know, and we kind of ignore that, and we kind of say, oh, being an adult is not worth talking about. Well, it is worth talking about, being an adult, because you have to make a lot of hard decisions and things like that. So okay. I'm just saying, you know, a bit of...
I suppose a festival is a time when you get to do that. You get to... it's time off, you know. You do get a chance to let go.
But I guess
you don't necessarily want to, because you're doing that in everyday life, being an adult. And yes, you're living it, and you discuss it, and you discuss work, and you have that. But then it's nice to go, I don't have work. But for me, what's just slightly cloying is that we have to do it inside this fence, and we're allowed to go and express ourselves and let ourselves free and open, but as long as we do it between these hours in this fence.
Right, okay, you know. So it's like a bubble, basically, it's what we were saying before.
We allow ourselves, I feel more open when I come here, that's why I like coming here, and it's an observation, it's not something that I aspire to, that's actually, you know, but unfortunately, what...
But it is a mindset that cross over. I mean, the festivals I've been to over the decades have always left me feeling refreshed when I go back to the real world. And I feel much more open with people generally. So you can kind of practice that openness in the outside world. And in that respect, and a lot of things actually, minority stuff, have come out of festivals to become mainstream now. So, you know, there's a lot of positive stuff.
I mean, was that the case when everyone's sitting around talking about politics as well?
Well, yeah, because musicians were motivated to play for political purposes, and fundamentally, it was a no to Thatcherism at the time.
Right. Okay.
And it had political implications of arrests and things like that. You know.
Okay, so there was a bit of a political edge, and you risked arrest. There you go. That's one of our cards. Do you know? Have you heard of Margaret Thatcher?
No.
No, Margaret Thatcher.
No.
Do you know Margaret Thatcher?
No.
Well, I think you have to explain. Do you know Margaret Thatcher? No. No. Come and get involved. We're talking about. Did Margaret Thatcher help to give the festivals a sense of edge? And now we don't have any Margaret. Come and join in. You know Margaret Thatcher. So basically, this is Talkaoke. It's a free-form talk show. Everyone's welcome. And then we're talking about, basically, Will said, have festivals lost their edge? They're not really interested in politics anymore. Dan's kind of hinted that there's a playfulness and there's an openness, which is political in itself, although maybe not overtly, but it's a different way of living, perhaps. But it's a shame it has to be in the bubble. I've forgotten your names, actually. What's your name again?
Tessa.
Tessa was saying that adults shouldn't play, weren't you? And you were saying that adults should play. So
she said that adults shouldn't play.
That was you that said adults should play. Yeah, okay. Anyway, so that's where we are right now. So is playfulness itself a political act? Have we lost our political edge? Come and sit down. Come and get involved. Okay, well, that's good. Come sit down and do that. Have you got a view on this?
Well, I was going to say, Margaret Thatcher was very famous for stealing ice cream off children.
Really?
Do you not remember that?
Really? She stole ice cream off of children?
That was her job.
I thought she stole milk off of children.
No, her original job, she was a chemist and she worked for an ice cream company. Her job was to increase the size of the gas bubbles in the ice cream. So she was, in fact, a child ice cream thief.
Wow. Okay. We didn't know that. Do you like ice cream?
Yeah.
How do you feel about a more bubbly ice cream?
Don't know.
Okay, would you prefer it or?
It would mean you get less ice cream in dough to get more air.
Would you like a more airy ice cream or a less aerated ice cream? This could decide your future political stance. I hope you realise this. Anyway, where are we going to go with this playfulness? Is it political in itself? Is playfulness political? That's what we're talking about over here. Or is it? Are we just ignoring all the things going on in the world, all the terrible, horrible things happening in the world? And I mean, what do you think?
Well, I think we're all enjoying this playfulness, aren't we? You just throw me with that.
You're trying to pull the debate here. I think they're into the. They're interested in the. They're happy here. I think. I do
like that. So many people put so much effort into bringing out the playfulness in us. I think we all have it.
Yeah.
But not necessarily we the platform for it in our daily lives, do we? I mean, if you've got children, playful quite often, but.
Do you think there should be more of a platform for playfulness in our everyday lives?
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, you're sort of agreeing with that as well, aren't you? Do you agree with that?
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Okay, some people are saying adults shouldn't be playful. You're saying adults shouldn't be playful. Should adults be playful? Is this somebody's dad over here?
I'm Amelia's dad.
Okay, which one's Amelia? Do you think your dad is playful?
No.
No, okay. Should he be more playful?
No.
No, you like him like that. Okay. Is that a wig? Okay. What do you think about this question of playfulness? Come and grab the mic. Get involved in this. What do you think?
To be honest, I think some of it, people sort of do make a big effort, like at this event. This is my first event, so it's new to me, but make a big effort. But sometimes I think some of it is a bit false.
It's a bit contrived, Okay.
I think people kind of pretend to be eccentrics when they're not.
Right.
And most of these people are not eccentrics, you know.
Okay.
Most people here are just normal, hardworking people.
Okay.
You know? But they're pretending. But you know, maybe that's part of it.
Okay. Yeah.
The eccentric is a nice aspiration to have, I think, as opposed to you know, a bureaucratic or like OCD, you know.
Okay.
Like,
One at a time.
Eccentric. You just are eccentric. Okay. So it's not something that you can sort of manufacture.
Okay.
It's clearly not. It's clearly not possible. Otherwise, all these people trying to be eccentric would be. But
we wouldn't be here. Actually, ironically. You know?
Okay. Let's see what we should put. Are you eccentric? Would you say? No.
At the festival, I bring this jacket because I like to wear a bit of colour. I usually wear quite dark kind of clothes, you know, because I work with bikes and it's very messy and I just doesn't make as much of a mess. So.
Okay, so are people pretending to be eccentric here when they're not actually eccentric?
They're trying to be eccentric or they're just trying to be copying or trying to aspire to be. Not necessarily
aspiring
to the extreme
to be
eccentricity, but
okay. So maybe it's an aspiration to be eccentric, and maybe it's a once again, it's this playfulness that you're actually.
But that's a nonsense, as I repeat, because you don't play at being eccentric. You just are.
Really?
You either are or you aren't. It's not some. Sure, you can explore aspects of yourself at a festival, and that is part of it. But most people here are just kind of copying each other.
Okay. Are you eccentric?
No.
No, okay. All right. Would you like to be eccentric?
No.
No, okay. Are you eccentric? We're talking about eccentricity here.
Do people just, are people aspiring to be eccentric? Is that why they're wearing all these strange clothes? What's going on? Come and join in. I mean, they're not eccentric enough to join the party.
Eccentric is like the one extreme, isn't it? A spectrum. There are a lot of people who are not there, but like you say, have got their own or want to be their own individual.
Yeah.
But there are some people I think feel that are sheep a little bit.
I mean, personally, I think that people, there's nothing wrong with, I don't think there's an essential nature of people that they're either eccentric or, what's the opposite of eccentric? Concentric. They're just, but maybe they're here, they can be more, it's more easier. Hello, come and join in. We're talking about playfulness. Have festivals lost their edge? That's what Will's saying. Basically, there's a bit. You think this one hasn't?
Edge. No, she's just on it.
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
She's great.
I mean, do you think this is what Will's saying, that we should all be talking more about politics and the real world?
No, that's the whole point of festivals. Just ignore the real world.
Yeah, yeah, let's talk about something else. World. You're always bringing it back to politics.
Yeah,
we want to.
Bringing kids to festivals.
Yeah. So what should
bring
it,
kids
what
to
should
festivals
it?
So they can see adults being playful, because you never
okay.
see that.
Well, it's interesting because some of the kids have said that they don't like to see adults being playful, and others have said they do like to see adults being.
I had a half-hour-long conversation with a six-year-old yesterday.
Yeah.
She loved me.
Okay, fantastic. I mean, was it your playfulness that she likes?
Yeah.
Okay, so adults should actually be playful. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. It's just, in my theory, it's real life. I feel like.
All right. Just in case you, this is going on the internet, on our website, I should just say. There we go. There's a card.
Thank you.
I like your team.
There's a card. Okay, and you've suggested, Dan, we should talk about something else. I don't know if other people... The whole point of Talkaoke is you talk about whatever you want to talk about, so we can move on.
We should talk about how connected we all are to everything around us.
Do you feel connected?
Very connected.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you go further and what does that mean, that feeling connected?
I don't know, like when you lie on the ground, like it could just like suck you in and take you in with you.
Okay,
is
that
what so you're feeling too? Definitely.
So is it the ground that connects you rather than the people that you connect to?
Yeah, man, and when you go like that, you can see like your spirit like
wow.
going along next to it. It's like a bit like the Matrix.
Okay. Can you see other people's spirits?
No. No.
Okay, these can't see the spirits.
They're not old enough yet.
Okay, they're not old enough. Okay, can you see any spirits?
No.
Okay. It's interesting, only certain people.
It's like a ghost.
Okay.
So, like, when you do stop frame animation.
Right, okay.
So I'm seeing every single frame.
Okay.
Whereas
people all the time.
Is this part of the playfulness of the festival?
It must just be the playfulness of the festival. Making me see everything.
All right. Have you played at this festival at all?
No.
No?
Yes. No.
Okay. Okay, so, I mean, I'm just going to come back to you, Will. So there's this sense of playfulness that people are really getting off of, and it's creating a sense of connectedness, actually. And isn't that in itself something to be... Like, look, we're all connected here. We've got all different people of different ages. Maybe we should just get a quick round of names. My name's Mikey. What's your name?
Dave.
And?
Should we say our age?
Poppy. Tessa.
Yeah.
Anna.
Yeah.
Danny.
Yeah.
Fran.
Yeah.
Dan.
Will.
And I'm Mikey.
I think we should all say our ages. Wait, I'm not
do you
want to
say
lie. I'm 20.
You're 20?
20.
Okay, what's your age?
4. 5. 3.
47.
41.
50.
30.
Okay, so...
I mean,
is it... You don't really even know. So is it important how old you are, do you think? Do you think it makes any difference?
Of course it doesn't, no.
No, you don't think it does?
Not when it comes to playfulness.
What's that?
I'm actually 1.
1? Okay, is it important how old you are? Do you think it's... Did you celebrate when you turned... Which one's 5?
Man, I'm fucking excited.
I'm 5.
Did you celebrate when you turned 5? Did you have a party?
Yes.
Yeah? Was it important?
Yes.
Yes, you say it's yes. Yeah. Is age important? That's what we're talking about at the moment.
It's yes.
Well, yeah. It depends what you're talking about.
Yeah. Do you think age is important?
Nah.
No?
Nope. It doesn't make a difference.
Okay. Does it make a difference?
I wouldn't be with a 50-year-old man, but
really?
That's kind of different. When we're talking about playfulness, yeah. age isn't
would
important.
Would you play with a 50-year-old man?
No! I've been with a 29-year-old, that's my oldest.
That's ageist.
I mean, we're talking about playfulness. We're just talking about playing. Would you play?
I don't know, actually. Dominic's here. He's like 53.
Okay,
There's no age limit. There's no age limit when it comes to playfulness.
Okay. Do you agree with that?
I agree.
No, okay. No, I mean, do you sometimes feel, as a 47-year-old man, that you're not allowed to play, that you're not allowed to be playful, you're not allowed to play with the young kids?
I think as a 47, you make your own decisions, don't you? If you want to have some fun and do something that what you want to do, as you get older, you become more and more sort of averse to what anybody else thinks. So yeah. You just get on with it. So you just get on with it.
The older you get, the more the age doesn't really matter because you lose count, as Dan has kind of.
If it feels wrong, it's in your head.
Okay.
That's why it feels wrong, because you've made something wrong about it.
Okay. Yeah. So it shouldn't be wrong.
Yeah, nothing should be wrong.
Okay.
Age is just a concept.
Well, you're the one who started the whole age thing, I have to say.
I wanted to know how old the kids were.
Okay. Oh, you'll see in a minute. So where do we want to take this conversation? We've got quite a diverse range of ages. We've got people in their 20s, 30s, 40s and 50s and in their zeros. So what are we going to talk? This is a very unusual kind of talk show where you've got such a mixed group of people. But what are we actually going to talk about? Is there anything that we can talk about? Come and get involved.
Stick with age.
What, have you got anything to say about age?
I think when I was 20, I probably had those kind of opinions.
Yeah.
And when you're 50, your opinions change because your body changes. So you do have a slightly different perspective when you're older.
Okay. So this is Talkaoke. It's a free-form talk show. At the moment, we're talking about ages because we've got such a mixed age range around the table. Do your opinions change with your age? Is it down to your body? Is it down to other things? What's your name, first of all?
My name's Jonathan.
Yeah?
I'm a bit older than 50.
Okay.
Things do change. They start to wear out. And
does anything not change? What doesn't change?
Spirit.
Spirit doesn't change.
Spirit doesn't change.
Yeah, we were talking, yeah.
My spirit's only 20.
Okay, all right. Okay.
Oh, 19.
I'm a unicorn.
You're a unicorn.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, maybe we should go around and find out what everybody's spirit is. Okay. We got some more people here. I wanted to give you your name and your spirit. So my name's Mikey, and I don't know what my spirit is. I'll come back to you later on that one. What's your name?
My spirit. I'm Dave, and I don't know what my spirit is.
Okay.
My name is Katnick, and my spirit is a jaguar called Sinbad.
Okay. Did you hear that? His name is Katnick.
My name is Katnick.
Is that like the girl in Hunger Games?
No, that's Katniss.
Oh, right, okay, close.
I'm a Katnick.
Okay, and your spirit is?
My spirit is a jaguar by the name of Sinbad. He's lovely.
Okay.
My name is Dylan, and I'm not really sure what my spirit is.
Maybe this can help you find out what it is.
Yeah, I'm searching. I'm not really sure.
What's your name again?
I'm Fran. She says my spirit.
Fran can see spirit, so she will be able to tell you.
She's a unicorn. I'm a unicorn.
Okay.
No such thing as spirit.
Okay. What's your name?
No such thing.
What's your name?
Will.
Will, but you don't believe in spirits.
Well, you don't need to, because we know that they're just chemical reactions.
Okay.
Well, I think he's absolutely right, because he lives in that particular thing.
Okay.
But he's not right because he doesn't live somewhere else.
Okay, so if you were to live in Fran's world, and he would see the spirits, possibly.
Well, if he has something which is in his body, which when he dies will go away.
Okay, we're going around, we're getting names first of all. So we've got Katnick, we've got, what's your name again?
Dylan.
Dylan, Will, Jonathan, what's your name?
Dan.
Dan, have you got any spirit, information?
Spirit? My spirit would probably be a cat.
Cat, yeah.
What do you, if he, a unicorn?
If I see spirits and like water animals, so if he was a water animal, he'd be a porpoise.
Okay, porpoise. What's the porpoise of that? Okay. Sorry, I had to do it. Okay. Yeah.
I'm Danny, and apparently I'm a dolphin, but okay. I don't know my name.
Okay, not a porpoise, a dolphin, no. A bottlenose dolphin.
Huh?
Bottlenosed. Okay, well, okay, and what's your name again?
Amelia.
What's your spirit?
Don't know.
Is it unicorn like Fran? No, definitely not. Okay, name?
Her name's, you might know her name because she has got...
Okay. What's your name?
Tessa.
And?
Poppy.
What's your spirit?
I don't know.
Okay, so there's a lot of people that don't know their spirit. They're open to the idea of having a spirit, but they don't know what it is. How do they find out? Is it just something that comes to them? How did you find out your spirit was a jaguar called Sinbad?
I met him in a psychedelic state.
All right, okay.
He's returned many times to give me a helping hand as and when.
How? What does he do?
He just leads me about. If I'm a bit lost, he'll be like, yeah, come this way.
Sinbad.
His name is Sinbad.
It's a jaguar.
The sailor.
Yeah,
the
very same.
Okay,
so, I mean, can we help someone like Will find these spirits, someone like Dan? Can we actually help them find their spirit? Someone like... Oh, they've gone now.
You have to find your own spirit. It's something you have to find yourself
okay,
on your own
disagree.
Little journey.
If we put something in your drink, I'm sure you'll be able to find your spirit.
Okay.
Find it, or does it come to you?
Okay.
It's a mixture of the two.
Okay, you just...
It's just an anti-scientific notion.
Okay.
Okay, that's all it is. You're pretending that there is such a thing as a spirit or a soul, and there ain't.
Science is only the truth that we've found through proving every other possibility wrong.
Experiments. Okay, all right, what's he going to say over here?
Wait, has he ever taken drugs, ever? Like,
Have you ever taken drugs?
More drugs than you've had hot dinners.
Okay, all right. Okay, and you've never found your spirit. Did you ever? You never went on a psychedelic journey.
I knew at the time that what was happening was a chemical reaction. If okay. I was honest.
Okay, Jonathan, have you got anything to say on this?
Oh, I think he's being honest. He is being very honest, but it's like he lives at the bottom of the pool, and he believes that everything at the bottom of the pool is where everything is. But
okay, a bottom dweller. Okay, I'll come back to you in a second. Yep.
That's why he vapes instead of smokes cigarettes. So.
Okay.
I should be smoking cigarettes.
Okay.
Vapes.
Okay, so...
It's all a chemical reaction.
Okay, I mean, can spirit be a chemical reaction and still be a spirit?
Yes, everything can be. A spirit is not a thing. A spirit is the way in which you are encapsulated by the feelings of those things which are unspeakable of.
Right.
You cannot speak about them because you go into an evening and there's a spirit of happiness, a spirit of depression, there's a spirit, you go into a funeral and there's another sort of spirit. The spirit used is clashing between the idea of spirit and the idea of well-being and how something something hasn't. You've made a distinction. You have to make a distinction between spirits and spirits and spirits.
Okay, it's lots. Okay, I see. What? See,
to me, right, science is about experiment, and if you experiment,
have you experimented? Like,
I've experimented in that. Right, I've encountered this particular. I've been open to new experiences, and every now and again, I'll encounter this cat-like being.
Yeah,
it'll guide me to places.
Sinbad.
Yeah, exactly. And it's simple enough. And I've cultivated it to a degree, but it's the language that we use to describe these things. That's where the conflict comes from. Because that's I can't say like, oh, you're a series of chemical reactions, but you're not a human. Like, it might be a series of chemical reactions, but it still appears to me as a cat, and it's my perception of that that makes it real.
Okay, okay.
You use the right word, it's a perception, but it's not necessarily real.
Okay.
Everything you perceive becomes your reality because you decide what you choose to perceive.
That's just not true.
Okay, alright, okay. So let's spread this out to the rest of the... hang on, guys, hang on. Let's spread this out to the rest of the table. What is perception, really? What is reality? Do we choose to perceive some things, or... Is it something deeper than that? Is reality deeper than our perception? We get very philosophical here. Come and join in. Bring your ice cream. Did you know that Margaret Thatcher invented that ice cream?
I want to join in.
What's that? You want to join in, but?
No, I'm not.
Do you need to be knowledgeable to join in this discussion?
I just want to say, like, like, human's vision, like, who's to say that's actually real? Yeah. Like, I know that sounds stupid.
It's a very good question. Like, how do we know what's
arrogant,
real?
It's quite arrogant just assuming, like, oh, yeah, that's reality, you know what I mean?
Like in the Matrix.
Like,
yeah.
Like, I don't know.
How do we know we're not living in a matrix?
Exactly.
How do we know what's real and what's not real?
Like, yeah.
You're holding the spirit of this conversation. You're the one who's holding it together. You're who's doing it. And you're doing it with good spirit. And that spirit is there, and it's provable because you're there.
Okay, so you think that's I'm proof enough?
No, you're not proof enough, but it's an example.
Because you're saying it.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is proof.
Okay, does that make it kind of real in a way?
I didn't.
Just the fact that it's happening, we're all agreeing that it's happening?
You have to understand the word realise. And realise means real eyes, not realise. Use your real eyes and you can see things. Can't you see anything? You can't see anything.
Okay, I see. Realise, do people use their real eyes? Dave, you haven't said much recently. Is it going over your head?
It is a little bit, yeah.
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 Okay.
Because I don't get the seeing things that Katniss does.
Do you believe in the spirit thing?
No.
No, not at all?
No.
If someone told you that, say, you had the spirit of a porcupine, would you agree, disagree?
Totally disagree.
Disagree, okay.
Disagree.
All right, so...
you're doing very well. Keep it going.
Okay.
Keep the spirit going.
Okay, thank you. But where do we want to go? The whole point of this is it's up to you. We've got all these wonderful people around the table. What do you want to talk about? We're here at Shambala. It's day one. Well, it's day two, maybe. I don't know.
To me, it's about levels of awareness, right?
Yeah.
So, like, the fact that someone's on one particular level of awareness and they focus on the physical matter structure of this matrix is cool, but it's about an awareness even of the possibility of other... levels of perception. Well, that's not for me to say because I'm not a levelist. I'm just someone that knows my experience, and I know that I've been in certain states of mind and things haven't behaved the same way. Sometimes a cat comes and leads me places. Like, if that's I call it a spirit because it's like a being that I can define.
Well, it's just a different kind of awareness.
It's a different kind of spirit to your spirit of enthusiasm that you've got here, or the spirit of joy. That's why language is such a big thing. But if you want to pinpoint it, you've got to use the same language as everyone in the room. So first, maybe we should agree what spirit is, and then we can define whether or not we have it.
Well, Jonathan's already said it's at least three different things.
Well, that's the thing. Like, which of those is it? Is it like the concept of an emotion, or is it like a being in itself with its own?
I'm pretty amazed that people in the 21st century are still talking about such things. Yeah. I really am. I mean, we really should be beyond the notion of souls and spirits and things like that. And I know I sound like Richard Dawkins, and I'm not particularly bothered about that.
What should people
there is no life after death, and there is nothing that can live beyond that that an ending of your body, because you are your body.
Well, what should
I feel the body of the earth, man. Like, there's life where there's life.
Okay.
If your life ends when your body ends, that's because of your mentality. But life will continue, and I guarantee you that.
Okay.
But there's nothing.
Okay.
Again, that's kind of nonsense, because all creatures that possess life, possess life in the form of DNA. Okay, so while I might be dead and my DNA has issued into dust, it may be at some level living in my children. In other animals, they continue to live, operating on their DNA. Okay, so the animating force is DNA. It's not. Okay. It's not a fucking spirit.
Okay, I just want to spread this out to this side of the table. I'll come to you in a sec, Dylan. So basically, I guess Will's saying we should have got over talking about all this stuff. Now that we know about DNA and stuff like that, we should have moved on from this discussion about spirit and animating forces. Do you believe in spirit? Come and have a seat on the table of chat. You're looking great.
Why is it still a discussion?
Yeah.
If we've got over it and all the science has like proved it,
okay.
Why is it still a discussion? Why are people still thinking?
Exactly. Yeah. So science can prove that there are more dimensions than ours. Like, if you take a plane, the first dimension just a line, and then you draw it across, you've got two dimensions and three, and that's where we live in.
Okay.
And
so we know there's other dimensions out there.
And it can be proven. You can see the shadow of you can generate the image, the shadow of a shape, a geometric shape from another dimension. In this, we can only see the shadow of it.
Okay.
With this with this perception, but maybe all the infinite dimensions that are going on are coming through and something picks it up, and that's thought, maybe, you know.
Okay.
There's infinite.
Okay, let me just bring in this, because we're coming at a very sort of freaky time where we're talking about, like, are there other levels? Will is saying, when we started talking about spirit and what is spirit, Katnick over here has got the spirit of a jaguar called Sinbad, but Will is saying we shouldn't be talking about spirit, it's all nonsense, all mumbo jumbo. Well, now we know about DNA, that conversation should be over. And then Dan is saying, well, there's other dimensions out there, and that's been proved scientifically, and that's where we are. Are there other dimensions, are there other levels, are we stuck in a kind of, in our own reality? That's really the conversation that's happening at the moment. Sorry, you know, we've hit you with something kind of heavy and...
They're not other. They're not out there for us to discover somehow. This is it. We are discovering it. Not even discovering. Okay. We can't discover it.
Yeah.
Is there anything beyond our actual experience? Because that's surely all that actually exists is what we can see, touch, feel, smell, think about. I don't know. Maybe.
Okay.
What's another dimension? If it's so abstract, like. I don't think there's other dimensions.
Okay, if you can't feel it, hear it, touch it, it's not there. You're shaking your head.
It's not part of our experience.
Yeah. I think we just need to engage with each other. Like, we have a miracle right here.
Yeah.
And it is Earth, and it's on Earth, and we should all just learn to appreciate each other more than trying to imagine things in outer space. We should just actually appreciate what we've got and.
Yeah.
I think that's all it's about.
Okay,
really.
I mean...
Does
the Earth have a spirit, do you think? Like, are we a part of that spirit of the Earth?
No.
Okay.
I think, like, look after the Earth, because...
Things on the Earth are alive, but what is spirit? This is so vague. Can someone tell me what spirit is, please?
Okay. Can someone say what spirit is? Maybe we can get... I mean, we could spend a lot of time here. Grab the mic.
Maybe it's the stuff between, like, the language that you speak, you know what I mean? Like, how you describe, like, a friendship, or how you like your children.
Can't really explain or describe.
Yeah.
Okay, nice shirt, by the way.
It's hard for us to describe because we have this barrier which, like, has many filters through the communication, which is language. So I can explain stuff as articulately as I want to you, but how you perceive it is down to you. Because... Okay. Like,
I mean,
is language the best thing
we've got to explain stuff?
Not always. The best thing is vibes. But, like, what are vibes? Vibes are everything. Like, every chemical reaction is caused because of vibrations that cause the heat in order for the environment of that to happen. Like, what's your consciousness? Like, if you don't believe in spirit, what's the difference between your DNA and your thoughts?
What are we talking about? There's a question here. Basically, this is Talkaoke. It's a free-form talk show. We sort of started talking about... Is there such a thing as spirit? Katnick over here is guided by the spirit of a jaguar named Sinbad. But Will says that's all nonsense. Since we discovered DNA, you know, we know what animates life, and why are we talking about this in 2015? So,
do we know what animates life? Like, to me, spirit is that animating consciousness behind all life, and that same consciousness that feeds me is the same consciousness that feeds my cells and makes them move towards some more acidic area of my body, is the same consciousness that moves me as a cell in the Earth, is the same consciousness that moves the Earth as a cell in the galaxy. Yeah. That's how I see spirit, and it's however much you tap into that, it allows things to manifest.
Okay.
Everybody smiles in the same language. Boom!
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So that's where we are. Basically, that's a quick recap. Come and have a seat on the table of chat. This is Talkaoke. It's a free-form talk show. You can talk about whatever you want to talk about. It's up to you. Come sit down.
Can we change the subject?
Yeah,
because
if you want
this, to.
Is it too heavy?
The universe is driving me mad.
This fucking universe is driving me mad. Oh, Jonathan, give us a final thought before. No, it's gone. Jonathan! Oh, it's gone. Okay, come and have a seat. Come and make this busy. What are we...
Talk about smartphones! Why do people use smartphones? They ruin everything.
Okay. Yeah, all right. Thank you. Smartphones. Okay, we can move back to smartphones. Come and have a seat on the table of chat. What's your name?
Ruby.
Okay, actually, we should get a round of names. My name's Mikey. This is Talkaoke. We've got Ruby. What's your name?
Craig.
And?
Dave.
Miffy.
Bob.
Welcome, Bob.
Dylan.
Dylan, yeah.
Will.
Hello, I'm Katnick.
And Dan and...
Rue.
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 Okay. Okay. Anyway, we're talking... It's been suggested that we should talk about smartphones. Is a smartphone here ruining this conversation?
Shit.
You think they're shit? What do other people think about smartphones? Have they ruined conversation?
Yeah, because although we can connect to anywhere in the world, we're not aware of those around us because we're too concentrated on what could be happening somewhere instead of living in the moment of where you are.
Bob?
I get to read the Guardian's website constantly, all day, every day. I spend like about over an hour every day. I can, anytime, it's great.
Okay.
I can see all the depressing goings on in like world news, politics, everything. Yeah, there we go. Broken.
Okay. Shut that shit up. Right. Okay. So, so smartphones have ruined stuff. Bob says no because he gets to read the Guardian website 24/7.
I think they haven't ruined anything. What we need to do is adapt. We need to set limits for ourselves.
Yeah.
Smartphones are here to stay. It's no good saying they've ruined everything. We need to set ourselves limits, and we need
what
to still.
What should
it be? Well, I don't know. Maybe like not using them in bed. Only use it on the toilet. I like playing Angry Birds when I have a poo. That's great.
Okay. I mean, has the smartphone actually improved people's pooing experience?
Yes. We've also got rid of skills that maybe we once had.
Right,
Shut up, Jack.
Okay.
Once upon a time, we might have been able to read a map, but nowadays, you don't need to read a map. You've got an iPhone. We've lost skills because of the iPhone.
You're checking your old smartphone. Is it because of this conversation? Are smartphones useful? Are they dumbing us down? Are they helping us to poo?
I think, there's loads of people here. They're all amazing and vibey. I love this man more than most people in the world. And despite
Dylan
indeed. Yeah. And despite his opinion on smartphones, he found me and a place to sleep tonight because he had a smartphone and I could call him.
Okay.
So even though there are like 20,000 people here, like we could leave it to chance or we could actually organise ourselves. And it's easier to have a kind of hive mind when you can call people.
But how does it affect the spiritual world?
It doesn't. It's a phone. You can make calls. In the spirit world, man, you just pull out your phone and dial cosmic, fine.
Okay, we did that super normal actually, but that's another story.
Where is the cosmic button? Tell me.
When is there going to be a connection to the spirit world on the smartphone? Come and have a seat on the table of chat. We're talking about smartphones. Are they ruining people's lives?
I think spirit penetrates all things and you can use a stick in the spirit world as much as you can use a phone. So if you're on some other level because you've eaten too many drops of acid, like that doesn't mean you can't pull out your phone and like connect to some divinity that you need to talk to. It just works through many levels.
Give us your final thought.
My final thought. Does it have to be...
It doesn't have to be distinct and profound, but it could be what's the most interesting thing you've heard while sitting on the table. You've been here for a little while, and we've been through all sorts of different passages, so to speak.
I'm interested that 2 out of 3 under 5-year-olds think that adults shouldn't be childlike, playful.
Yeah, that was a bit earlier on. Kids were saying adults shouldn't play. 2 out of 3 kids said adults should not play. We don't like the way adults come to this, and they're playing too much.
Society.
Yeah.
That's why.
Yeah.
No, I mean like that. That's why like economics, political life is just so grim. Like.
Yeah.
Because those sort of people are the majority.
Okay.
What do you mean?
Those sort of people. Do you think those kids actually the fathers around somewhere? Do you think those kids will grow up to become politically
fascist?
Thank you. I can't really add things in as my job as a host,
fascist!
But you can. Yeah.
Yeah.
You think that's potential upsurge of fascism in the future?
And
I think there's an upsurge of apathy. There's an upsurge of absolute political apathy that we're struggling with. There's an upsurge of single issue politics and apathy, and people who aren't engaging with actually what's going on.
Okay, so this is Talking Against the Freeform Talk Show. At the moment, we're talking about, is there an upsurge of apathy? That's what. What's your name?
Craig.
Craig. That's what Craig's saying. That's what Craig is saying, that there's an upsurge of apathy. We believe this because three out of four children at this table earlier on said that adults shouldn't play. They shouldn't be playful. Actually, Will said it as well, but anyway, that's another story. Come and join in, come and get involved. Are we experiencing an upsurge of apathy? Oh, that's what we're talking about.
Craig is absolutely right. There is a big disengagement from politics. And
yeah.
Well, because politics is about justice and, you know, and change and, you know, the ability to sort of manage a society. And if you don't care about that, you only care about yourself.
Yeah.
So it has to mean something.
Okay. Do you think adults should play? Should be playful?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. All right. There we go. Okay, yeah. Okay, so are we experiencing an upsurge of apathy? You read The Guardian at least an hour a day. Do you experience an upsurge of apathy?
Not at all.
No?
Jeremy can.
Yeah, but you're not voting for Jeremy Corbyn, so shut up.
Okay.
In the circles I'm in, I agree with Craig. There's a lot of apathy.
Yeah. Okay.
I go to groups of activist groups, and there are no young people. Everybody is old. Everybody's great.
What sort of activist group?
Well, particularly Palestine, but a lot. I have to bring Palestine up. Everyone's going to be annoyed.
Yeah.
But it's true. It's all old people. Palestine. Nobody young cares about Palestine.
Okay.
Why is that?
Okay. Well, we've had quite a few people leave the table just in this session.
Yeah.
But let's get this man with the green hair. Do you think about Palestine? Have you heard of Palestine? Okay.
Why
do you want to come and sit down? Come on, we'll tell you about it. Okay. Do you know about Palestine? Can someone explain Palestine? Yes. What is Palestine?
Like in the corner, Palestine.
Relax.
Okay. Yeah.
Breathe in first of all.
So you're just talking about green.
Let's get your name first of all. What's your name?
Sunny.
We'll do a round of names. Ruby, Craig,
Miffy,
and Bob, and Will, and Mikey. Okay, so basically, Ruby is interested in Palestine, but she's frustrated that it's only people with grey hair that seem to be interested in it. So she's going to try and get you to be interested in it. Yeah.
What do you care?
Yeah. Yeah.
How about, do you know anything about politics? Are you interested in politics?
No.
No, not really.
What's your favourite thing?
Come and sit down. Come and get involved in this. There's no age limit on this Talkaoke show, unlike the activist groups that Ruby frequents.
I'd like to know what Sunny would like to change about the world.
Yeah, good idea.
Okay, all right, that's a good question. I'm going to turn. We've got a technique called turning the mirror, and what that means is when someone asks someone a question, we bounce it back. So I'm going to ask you, what would you like to do? I'm going to go around the table, in fact. What would you like to change about the world?
With the risk of sounding like a yoghurt-weaving liberal, I'd like to see more compassion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd like our political structures to change so that the resources are not so concentrated in the hands of the few. And it's restructured to benefit all the people who don't start off with the life chances that those who get there.
Okay,
do.
We don't want a manifesto. We don't want a manifesto. We just want one thing. So that's great.
Less judgment.
Less judgment. Okay. Yep.
I'd like to see children ruling.
What? Okay. What would you like to change about the world? We're going around.
I think all the people in Africa should like.
Yeah.
Get money, water, and all that type of stuff to save them.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So we're talking about what would we like to change about the world. I'm going around. I'm gonna What do you like to change about the world?
I'd like people to be kinder to the basics, so to start with animals, because I think if you are kind to everything, if you're kind and respect life, it carries on through the whole
life. Is there any particular animals you think people need
to
be...
No, just life, to
just
respect
all life. Okay.
Yeah.
Kinder to all life. Okay, we're going to go around. Come and have a seat. Don't be shy. I'm going to ask this person with another human being on his shoulders. What would you like to change about the world?
Yeah, just a little bit of easy living. You know, everyone have some fun.
Yeah, more fun.
Yeah, yeah. Just like festival time. It's all good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You think that should be festival time should be extended?
Yeah, yeah. It's all life, all days.
So let the festival bleed into the real world. What would you like to change about the world? Nothing. What would you like to change about the world?
And more sports.
More sports. Any particular sports?
Nothing really, just more exercise.
Okay. What do you like to change about the world?
I'd like to move England further south to make it warmer.
very popular choice. What do you like to change about the world?
Get rid of borders. Free travel.
Get rid of borders.
Yeah.
Okay. Borders. So that basically what you're saying is that all kids should go to school and come back on the same day. Okay, no one really got that. Anyway, doesn't matter.
Okay.
Yeah.
100% renewable energy. It's like fossil fuels. We're going to hell in a handcart and we're destroying the planet.
Yeah.
It's simple. We just need to start using like 100% renewable energy and then
more renewable.
All the problems will go.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, of course. Well, you can do this however you want to do it. What do you like to change about the world?
What do I want to change around the...
about the world?
The world?
Yeah.
I thought it was like maybe underkill.
It'd be nice if everyone was actually friendly to each other.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's been the most popular choice. That's been the most popular choice. Okay, so there we go. Is that politics?
Yeah.
Is that Yeah. Okay.
Sorry, we're talking about politics.
Well, no, we're not necessarily. It's just that Ruby brought up Palestine earlier on.
No, if you're actually talking about politics, like...
Child-friendly.
Right.
Well, why don't you say it?
They're not friendly. And that's unfortunate, but that's reality.
Do people agree with that? Has anyone met some unfriendly people?
The guy I met when I came here stole a bottle of gin, no, rum off me, so he was...
What, here
friendly.
In Shambala?
Yeah.
Wow.
In a glass bottle.
Okay.
It's not technically... Not technically stealing.
Okay.
That is still unfriendly, though. Yeah, it's
you think that's unfriendly? Yeah. Okay.
I said I'll decant it into a water bottle, and he said, one strike and you're out, and stole it off me.
Yeah. Wow.
That's not friendly. That's not Shambala vibes.
Okay.
I've met a lot more friendly people than non-friendly people so
far. You think more people are friendly already. So we're nearly at... What's your name?
Tom.
We're nearly reached Tom's...
Right.
Yeah.
Truth be told, like, people are horrible.
Really?
And that is just how it is.
What? Give us an example of people being horrible.
Every day.
Yeah.
Like day in, day out.
Yeah.
People are really unpleasant.
No, but I want to know an example. What?
Nah, you're fucking kidding yourself.
Yeah.
All right, sorry.
Okay, can someone give us something? We've had one example of unfriendliness that somebody got a bottle of gin taken away from them. Is there any other examples of unfriendliness that we could maybe deal with? anywhere in the world, because we're talking about the world. You, Craig, yeah.
I had quite a typical Shambala experience moments ago at the main stage of meeting two or three complete strangers.
Yeah.
And we embraced and met each other and said where we're from, and it was great. And
they've probably been to the hugging workshop.
What is it perhaps about this environment that makes us do that we wouldn't do in Bristol?
Yeah, and what was it?
It's a question.
Okay. All right, so... Craig is saying people are actually more friendly and more open to each other here in the festival. Why? Why don't they do it in Bristol, which is famous for its unfriendliness?
I think it's because of everybody's outfits.
Yeah.
By the way, everyone here looks amazing.
Okay.
I think that improves everybody's.
Yeah.
I went to Bristol, and in Bristol, people in shops give you eye contact.
Yeah.
They talk to you. I found people in Bristol were friendly. I'm in Oxford.
Yeah.
No one gives you eye contact.
Maybe because you've got your sunglasses on.
Oh. Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so Bristol, it's got eye contact, but does it have embracing? Maybe not. Are people more friendly here in the festival? What are people thinking? Why can't it happen around the rest of the world? If it is the case. Do you think people are more friendly in this festival than they are out elsewhere?
Definitely.
Why?
Because it's... like the rest of the world is like billions of people, and this is only like... thousands of people.
Okay, so it's less people. Less people, okay, so it's less hectic. I'm going to ask other people, do you agree with this on this side, that people are more friendly here at the festival than they are, say, in Bristol or Oxford, which is where people don't even give you eye contact?
I mean, I live in London, and yeah. Most people think London's an unfriendly place, but yeah. It isn't, actually.
Yeah.
People will spend time talking, and it's you just have to make an effort. That's my experience.
Okay, so it's about making an effort. Maybe, but it's easier to make an effort here in the festival. Okay.
Go see a band.
Give us a final thought. What band are you going to see? And then give us a final thought. I don't know them.
I didn't hear the question.
What? Give us a final thought, basically.
You said before that. You said something.
I said, what band are you going to see?
We're going to go and see...
Disraeli. Free Palestine!
Okay.
No.
We're yeah, okay. Final thought. No, final thought.
Be nice to each other.
We love you.
Just yeah, okay. Be nice.
Okay.
I guess my thought is that it's been a real pleasure, and thanks for facilitating this.
Well, you know what, Craig? It's been a massive pleasure on my side as well. I have to say that. Yeah?
His name's actually Dom.
Well, it can be Craig here. Okay. I don't know. It sort of feels like we've come to a natural end, so maybe we should get a final thought.
It's the band starting. It's not you. It's
yeah.
The band.
I know. It's... final thought, Tom?
No.
You don't have one?
I've said enough.
You've said enough. Bob, final thought?
Let's make this happen.
How?
Jazz we can. Like, positive social change.
Yeah, okay.
Jeremy's going to get elected, okay. And then we can just, he'll win the 2020 election, and then we'll live in paradise.
Okay.
That's where we're going.
I look forward to that.
It's optimistic.
Yeah, that's true. It's true. I've paid my £3 anyway.
Yeah,
okay, final thought.
Are you shutting down?
We're shutting down for a brief moment, so I can go for a wee wee.
Final thought, where's the tent?
That's a very tense question. Final thought?
Good talk show host, and I like the way you kind of rounded it up each time, told people what was going on, keeping it interesting and light at the same time. So excellent.
That's what I try and do. I mean, not necessarily light though, because you know, so potentially
this could be marketed, I don't know, to the BBC or something.
Although
Glastonbury is mainly on the BBC these days, isn't it?
It's too free. I think that's the issue. But I will say, we could have gone deep and philosophical. There was a moment, there was a moment when we're talking about perception and reality. We could have gone really deep into it, but the people didn't want to go that way, you know.
They get scared off, you know. People just sort of put up barriers as soon as there's something that there is a little bit kind of challenging to them.
Yeah.
And that's a bit of a shame.
Is it down to this dumbing down that we sort of
probably yeah, it's to do with the idea that you're at a festival, therefore you turn off your mind, you know. You kind of just get off your face, and you know, that's it's only part of it, really, isn't
okay.
it? That I could do with a beer, I must say.
Okay, I've actually run out of beer as well, so I do apologise for that. Hello, come and take a seat. We're just finishing, but you're very welcome to sit. You're very welcome to listen and sit on the... although we actually stopped now, but you have a seat. Come and have a seat if you want.